people will be seeing the stream momentarily. We're just streaming stuff now. That's the way it goes. Testing some things. People are totally going to get an ad. It's going to be hilarious.
Time to monetize this bitch. Here come the ads.
Next up,
product placement. Oh.
The logo's already like on the whiteboard, man.
Boy, this Starbucks coffee's good.
It's funny. Oh, look, it's a Mountain Dew amp. It's terrible.
Good thing my phone's protected by OtterBox.
Monetizing bitches is illegal in this country. That's not nice. We'll see if the stream works, Victor. Well, not that anybody can hear it. Yeah, maybe. You have to turn the volume down on your computer.
Oh yeah, I gotta turn the volume down. That's no good. Oh, shit, now I can
see. Hi everybody. How's it going? What's up? We're not starting yet. We're just practicing. Disturbing commercial is
disturbing. Oh, that's weird.
What's weird?
The delay.
The delay's weird.
It's like watching somebody else.
Yeah, I know, right? It's crazy.
I gotta not look at them. Oh. Just put my hand over.
Hopefully this works okay. We'll see.
Jesus.
Hopefully. I think I can close this one because I could just use the dashboard. 13 people in there. Cool.
Pop
out the chat and not look at the stream. Interesting.
13 people in there.
The delay is actually... Oh, the delay is
this one because I can just use the dashboard.
Pop out the chat and not look at the stream. Interesting.
I got it.
13 people in there.
The delay is actually... Oh, the delay is
this one because I can just use the dashboard.
You can look at your past self.
I'm just going to put the delay
like that thing is still going.
It shouldn't be. I don't
now
know.
Now it's better.
It's better now? It's better now. It's better now?
Now it stopped, yeah.
Jib's saying he thinks it's the speakers on somebody's laptop. But
It might be the speakers on... What if it's the speakers on this thing? No, turn you all the way down.
I'm completely muted on this one. Nothing's plugged in on that one.
Is it looping like crazy again?
So it's not me.
Is it looping like crazy again? Okay. I'm going to hit play. I'm going to hit play because the soundboard is part of the show. And if it goes crazy, let me know.
This is the Misdirected Mark Podcast, a podcast about gaming, game mastering, and entertaining you, our listeners.
We're okay.
We are explicit, and you have been warned, and I'd like to thank Mike Willard for letting us use his music on our show. Now let's pick up those mics and get on with this thing.
Okay, alright. If that's good, then I'll just leave it like that. Okay, we'll do it that way. Alright, we have to start the show, so I'm going to start the show now.
Let's attempt to not blow up the show.
First off, I have to start recording, for reals.
Okay. I drink some coffee.
You drink some coffee. Okay. Hi, everybody. Thanks for bearing with us all 10 of you who are here, thank you for being here live with us. Sorry that we destroyed your ears for a second. We fixed it. I apologize.
All right, I'm good.
I'm going to start the show now.
Light that thing up.
Oh, I have to do one more thing first. I have to start actually recording this because that way we have a backup.
Seriously, I got to kind of not look at myself while we do this.
I knew you were going to get messed up with that.
Here we go. Really? 3, 2.
This is the Misdirected Mark Podcast, a podcast about gaming, game mastering, and entertaining you, our listeners. We are explicit, and you have been warned, and I'd like to thank Mike Willard for letting us use his music on our show. Now let's pick up those mics and get on with this thing.
Oh my. On this episode of the Misdirected Mark Podcast, we're going to gather up our crew, case the joint, and steal the MacGuffin out from under Mark's nose.
Yes.
My name is Chris.
And, hey, I'm Phil.
He's back! Oh my god, he's back!
We missed you so much! The prodigal son has returned.
He has returned. Yay. He has returned.
And I, of course, am Old Man Logan.
Yes, you are Old Man Logan. All right, man. Phil, man, what's going on?
What's going on? Well, I'm back.
You are back.
You guys did a nice job. You didn't tear my place up while you were gone.
Why would we do that?
We behaved.
Yeah, you guys were
well behaved. We took care of business.
Yeah.
It was weird.
You know why? Because we're this. The super friends.
Super friends.
Yes.
You guys are my best friends.
All right.
Anyway, yeah, 2 weeks.
Keep going.
That, by the way, is the Kermit head.
That is the Kermit head.
That's, if you're wondering,
all right,
go watch Talking Games, and you can find out more about that. Anyway, yeah, 2 weeks, man, on the road for work and a lot of work stuff, man. I was kind of dying. I went to Chicago, and by went to Chicago, I mean I went out to the airport and stayed there for 3 days, and it's all right. I did, by the way, take PK Sullivan's advice, who almost ruined the weight loss challenge for me by introducing me to Garrett's popcorn. I learned about the Chicago mix. It is half cheese popcorn and half caramel popcorn mixed together. At first, you might think that can't possibly go together.
I think it works.
Oh, it totally goes together.
Totally goes together.
Yeah. Anyway, it was good. I was going to hook up and see PK on my last night there. And then there was a major outage at one of the campuses that I support. And so I spent 4.5 hours in my hotel room on a conference call trying to get email restored to this campus. And anyway, so I did that. And then I was home for a couple of days. And then I went to Lake Placid, New York. And I went up to Lake Placid, New York, and went to another conference. You guys are killing me. It's been 2 weeks. Are you telling me I'm not close enough to the
mic? You're not close enough to the microphone, Phil. Just pull the mic back a little bit towards you.
Just turn down my volume because I think I sound like super loud.
Sure.
Which is why
There you go. Is that better?
Yeah, sorry, now man. I'll get closer to the mic.
You just have to tell me.
Yeah, well, all right. It's been 2 weeks. I'm a little rusty.
Yeah.
It's a process.
There we go. All right, I'm back. Anyway.
Oh, my God, that's loud.
See, I told you. Anyway, I went to Lake Placid, New York. And did a work conference for a couple days, and that was it was all right. Food was terrible, but the location's really nice. The food at the conference was actually pretty awful.
All they have up in Lake Placid is what, gator meat?
No. The caterer for the conference was like really bad. I mean, normally conference food is so-so, but it was really bad.
Really bad.
Yeah. Anyway, I drank a lot though. So that part was really good. And that's about it. And then I didn't game for like 2 weeks. So I, by Father's Day, like had a complete like crash.
You do realize it's actually inaccurate.
I played one game.
We played two.
No.
We played Swords Without Master, and then we played Action Movie World.
Not in the same day.
Yes.
Serious?
Yeah.
Man, it didn't feel like it. Anyway, we did. An Action Movie World. We got to talk about that at some point.
We will. In fact, we will do an in-depth on that game at some point.
Yeah, Action Movie World was stupid fun.
Stupid fun.
Yeah.
Yep.
That came out of nowhere. Martin Ralia tagged it, and I bought it and fell in love with it. So stupid fun. Anyway, you actually came and rescued me on Father's Day with games. You
tried.
And Bob.
Yep.
We try. We do the best we can.
Yeah. Well, that was fun. We played Lanterns. We played a little bit of Relic Hunters.
Relic Hunters.
I got yelled at on Twitter. Somebody has a video game called Relic Hunters.
Really?
They're like, hey, bro. They're like, we've got a game called Relic Hunters. I'm like, hey, listen, it's a working title. I'm selling this thing to a game company.
Jesus.
They can rename it when it's over.
I didn't even see that. That's crazy.
Yeah. Some app game or something. Mm. I don't know. Anyway, I did that, and I got my hands on some cool game stuff.
Nice.
I mean, you actually got me a nice, cool present.
I, in fact, did. I brought you back Bubblegum Shoe.
Yeah.
And on the inside of it, I got Ken Height to sign it.
You did.
And he wrote, a long time ago, we used to be friends, and then Phil probably didn't know what the hell it meant.
Because I hadn't watched Veronica Mars.
He's never seen a single episode of Veronica Mars.
On a good note, I can actually just sit and watch it now, right?
Yeah.
I could just go binge it.
Yes. Yes, you can.
So, which I'd like to do at some point.
And I think you should. I really think you should.
And anyway, where did you pick up Bubblegum Shoe, Chris?
Oh, I was at Horigens.
Yeah, so why don't you talk about that
for a minute? Did I just say Horigens?
You kind of did. It's a little awkward.
I was at Horigens.
I was
Origins.
Just going to play it off. That was but bizarre. I was going to play it off, but then you said something about it. Now,
misdirected Mark, word scramble.
Ooh. It's Origins.
Origins.
Yeah, there you go.
Origins. I was at Origins. I will give my Origin highlights in the social media depository.
Sounds good to me.
And I have been keeping up, trying to keep up with everything else because I was gone for 3 days because I was lucky enough to stay with some friends down there, a very good friend of ours.
Yes.
Yeah.
A business partner of ours.
Mm-hmm. More importantly, though, things that's going on with me.
Yes.
Today, the tickets for Hamilton in Chicago went on sale.
Yes.
And I'm going to go. I got tickets for December.
Yeah. I'm actually surprised that you didn't start the show like you did during the entire pre-show, which was basically as the cast of Hamilton.
I might eventually rap in song at some point.
Yeah, you've been binging the soundtrack for that some pretty fierce.
Right? I've the 2 hour and 5 minute soundtrack and I think 32 seconds, I have listened to from front to back at least 9 times now, and I've listened to individual songs more times than that because it's pretty brilliant.
Yeah. So there's that.
Yeah, there is that. Other than that, not much else is going on with me. I'm getting ready for my wedding. That's happening soon.
I'm getting ready for your wedding. That's happening soon. I got ready for your bachelor party.
Yeah, that's happening next weekend. So you might hear some stories or probably not on the next episode.
No.
There'll be a whole section called Shit We Can't Talk About at Chris's bachelor party.
Oh, that's funny.
It's actually going to be fun. It's a 3-stage bachelor party. There's some gaming.
Yes. Yes, it is.
Then there's some video gaming and dinner.
Mm-hmm.
And then there is dancing.
There's dancing.
Ballet
in Canada.
That's right. Yeah. Canadian ballet.
Yeah.
For you listeners that have a border near you, you'll know what that means.
Yes.
Anyway.
Like you do at bachelor parties, apparently.
Like you do at bachelor parties. Anyway, I just finished all the arrangements for the dinner and stuff. It's actually quite nice. We're going to have it's a Dave and Buster-like place, and we have unlimited gaming. So we're going to... we're going to have a lot of fun. We're going to play like a ridiculous amount of video games and shit.
Yes. Yes. We will be. Bob, man, what's going on with you?
Oh, man.
I'm sorry. Old man Logan, what's going on with you?
Right. People understand.
Yeah.
What's going on with me? I just finished up working on a thing for Third Eye Games. So that's done.
Oh, that's is that the revision?
Yeah.
Yeah, for Amp, your one?
Yeah.
Sweet.
Took a little break, played some Minecraft. So, you know.
Oh man, you played some Minecraft? Did you play 1.7?
We're still on 1.7, yeah, because we're using a bunch of mod packs that haven't been updated to.
No, then you're not on 1.7. 1.7 is the newest one.
No, so
you're like on 1.6.
1.9.
Oh, is it really?
1.9 something.
It's the last time I played that game.
Yeah, you played 1.9 because that's when
I played 1.9. I just forgot the version of it.
When you two are done arguing about which version of Minecraft you're playing,
what else? I'm doing podcasts. Slowly working on figuring out what my new coffee is going to be for my Keurig, you know.
Turning into a coffee shop. Everybody got Keurigs now.
Yeah. And, that's, you know. Oh, and I made a killer chorizo ranch meatloaf yesterday that's just dying to be eaten.
I saw pictures of it on pictures of it on Facebook.
I have to work on my loaf forming skills because they're kind of irregular and, you know. But, anywho, that's me.
Okay, then. Well, that's what's going on with us. We'll be right back after this as we go to the workshop to talk about stealing stuff. Welcome to the workshop, where we try to build better games. Phil, the heist is a time-honored genre. It is able to be the genre for a given session, or a one-shot, or can be the setting of an entire campaign. Mr. Vecchione, it is one of your favorite genres, if not your favorite genre, of stories. Would you please tell us about The Heist?
I do love The Heist. Ever since I was like a kid, man, ever since I saw The Sting, man, I've always loved The Heist.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, we're going to talk about The Heist tonight, and we're going to break it down like we did when you did Two-Fist Pulp Action. So we're going to talk about basically what makes up a heist. We're going to look at some of the elements, things about setting, play style, and characters. And we'll round out the section kind of talking about what makes a good heist in RPGs, because what makes a good heist in a movie isn't exactly the same thing as what makes a good heist in an RPG.
True facts.
So when we're talking about heists, we have a lot of source material. And I think a lot of source material that listeners, of course, will be familiar with. I mean, first of all, Leverage.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's a whole series, right? Like, if you want to talk about campaigns about stealing stuff, that's Leverage, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
But if we want to talk about individual scenarios or something, and we're still relating it back to other media, there's Firefly. There's the whole episode where they're stealing the laser gun.
Yes, there's that one.
That's a fantastic heist.
It's a great one.
Movies, The Italian Job.
Oh, it's fantastic.
The whole Ocean series, but really just Ocean 11.
I like 13.
13's all right. I mean, 11's perfect.
12, yeah. 12 is actually a good model for how to run a series of adventures that are revolving around a campaign and a heist.
Yeah. 12, I mean, of all of them, 11's still my favorite.
Yeah, but like, if you're looking for a model for how to run a campaign that is a heist campaign, 12's actually pretty good.
Yeah.
Because they have multiple jobs that they have to do.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good point. And then we've got Heat.
Oh, yes.
Oh, I so love that. So
I do also love Heat. I've seen Heat, just so you know.
Oh, good.
In case you're wondering.
No, that's good, because that's a fantastic movie. The A-Team is in some ways at times a heist.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. Bob, one of your favorite books, Lies of Locmora, right?
Lies of Locmora, yeah. And to a certain degree, the third book, Republic of Thieves, is like a very elaborate heist.
Yeah. If we actually get into role playing games that kind of talk about heists, obviously the Leverage role playing game.
Uh-huh.
And then we've got Shadowrun and Cyberpunk tend to have the run.
The run is
often a heist.
So I mean, when we get into talking about the heist, we're gonna probably talk about the box.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. We totally are.
Yeah.
So yeah, Shadowrun, Cyberpunk 2020, Blades in the Dark.
Yes, there is heisty parts of that. I mean, there's other things to it too.
Yes. But actually, and it'll be cool when we kind of talk if we get time to talk about it. Is how Blades in the Dark handles certain parts of the heist. That's a little different than the way older games did.
Mm-hmm.
Crime World.
Yes, because it was written by
John Rogers.
John Rogers.
From Leverage.
Yep.
And
so this one I dropped in there at the back
thank
end.
Thank you.
So the most recent novel of the Dresden Files, Skin Game, is a heist, and it's pretty great.
A Dresden heist?
Yes.
Yep.
That actually sounds pretty awesome.
It is pretty awesome. They go and they steal something from Hades.
See, now, that could be the way I get into the series. It's like, do I have to read everything in
kind,
order to...
Like, we'd have to give you a primer, otherwise you won't get some of the characters. But Butcher's pretty good about explaining stuff.
I mean, I know enough basic
read
stuff.
Read the Wikipedia entry for the series.
And then just jump right into... Yeah. Like, I would do that.
It's not as meaningful if you don't know who Nicodemus Arc Leone is. It's not as meaningful if you don't understand him and his daughter a little bit. It's not as meaningful if you don't understand Murphy and his relationship, or you know where Butters has come from.
Butters?
Yeah, Butters is the local...
Medical examiner,
no, it's fine. It's just, you know, when you say Butters, I think of South Park.
Oh, his name is Waldo Butters. So. Gotcha. So he's a little Jewish guy with glasses who loves Star Wars and games and stuff. He's like us. It's great.
And Polka.
Yeah, he's a Polka guy.
I would be remiss if I did not mention one more... one more game while we were talking about heists. And that would be, of course, One Last Job.
Yes, ding, of ding, course.
Ding. That is often mentioned on our other podcast.
Talking Games.
It's almost like a third co-host of the podcast.
One Last Job?
Yeah.
It didn't get mentioned in the last episode.
I know. In fact, I think we actually mentioned that it didn't get mentioned.
No, that was episode 15.
Oh, yeah. We're talking about locations.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But anyway.
How do you not talk about location? How do you talk about locations and not mention One Last Job being a heist? Because heists are generally based around locations.
Yeah, but we were talking about adventuring in certain locations.
That's true.
Anyway, because that's in the social... We can talk about that when we get to the social media and podcast roundup and stuff.
I suppose.
Anyway, now that I've mentioned one last job, I feel like we could move into kind of talking about what goes into a heist.
So, first off,
yes,
what is a heist?
Yeah, so we got to, I mean, we got to do a little deconstruction here, right? Mm-hmm. If we're going to define mm-hmm. a heist. So, I mean, at the core of every heist, you are stealing something from someone, right? Like, that's it. That's,
yes.
I mean, in its simplest definition, you are taking something from somebody who has it, and they don't want to give it to you.
So now we're going to posit that there are four main pieces for a heist.
Yes.
All right, so what are those four main pieces?
All right, the first one is the MacGuffin, right? It's the thing you're going to steal.
Yep.
And
be it the painting, the information, whatever.
It literally is the MacGuffin, right? Because in some places, it doesn't even matter what it is.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
in other places, it matters quite a bit. Then there's the box.
Which is technically the location.
Yeah. The box is where the MacGuffin is located.
Mm-hmm. Be that a physical space or even cyberspace.
Correct. Yeah, actually, that's very good. Then there's the opposition.
Those people who are controlling the box.
Correct.
And who have the security around the box.
Yeah, I mean, they often do. They're the people who don't want you to take the MacGuffin.
Mm-hmm.
And about that, then there's the team.
The people who are going to steal the MacGuffin.
Yeah, and the team has a couple different names. The team, the crew.
Mm-hmm.
Crew is fairly popular if you're looking at like modern crime kind of stuff.
Oh yeah,
crew is actually one of my favorites.
See, strangely enough, we didn't mention this earlier. One of my favorite sort of crime-ish type shows, like that has heists in it and such, is White Collar.
White Collar is excellent. And the new Shonda Rhimes drama on ABC.
How to Get Away with Murder. The one with the husband and the girlfriend and the boyfriend. I can't remember the name of it. Somebody will get it though.
Bob can search it out real quick. Anyway, that show is phenomenal. Like that, it's stupid fun. Okay, so if those are our components, right? The MacGuffin, the box, the opposition, and the team.
Those are the four things that you need to have a heist.
Right. And because of that, it's fairly genre neutral.
Yeah, it's not I suppose you could call it an elemental genre.
Yeah, if we were going to use the writing excuses kind of term, it is kind of an elemental genre.
Maybe, I think. Like the mystery.
I mean, they'll yell at us later, but...
That's fine.
The heist is... I mean, the heist really is setting neutral. In fact, that's one of the coolest things about it is setting it in different places.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Like, it's fun to do a fantasy heist.
Well, yeah, the first book of Brandon Sanderson's, to once again make another writing excuses reference, from the Mistborn trilogy, or Mistborn series, is a heist.
Yep.
So.
Modern, of course. Science fiction heists.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. So that's the really cool thing about a heist is that it is...
I mean, think about Return of the Jedi at the beginning of it. It goes wrong, but the whole point is to steal Han Solo back.
That's a heist,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, it's a heist. It just doesn't go right.
That's when they're on Tatooine.
On Tatooine.
Right.
Right, so the primary planet of that movie.
There are other planets.
The secondary planet of that movie is Endor.
Yes.
In my opinion.
I think you're correct. Tatooine, then Endor. Yes. Just to clear that up.
Just to clear that up. You'd have to see Talking Games to see what's going on there.
To answer your question, The Catch?
The Catch. That show is, it's really good.
I will have to watch it at some point.
Yeah, binge it. It's not, I mean, there aren't a ton of episodes, and it's very entertaining. It's a pretty sexy show, actually.
So, the setting. We were talking about setting. Well, there's no default setting. And the setting is pretty much the box, right?
Yeah. Well, the setting, the location, the setting is the box. Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, everything else around it are trappings of your overarching setting, but the setting for a heist is primarily the box.
Yeah. So
maybe your headquarters too. I mean, if you think of Leverage, every episode of Leverage and every actual adventure of Leverage, like scenario of Leverage that you design, because I've actually read through the Leverage role-playing game.
Sure.
You defined it actually pretty well. You could have written that section, strangely enough. I know you never have seen that book, so it's pretty good. The location is the box.
Yes.
Like, what are you breaking in? What are you stealing? Things like that.
And so there's two actually elements of that. So if we break down the box a little, there's the physical location, right? So we can have, like, let's say we're doing a fantasy heist. Our physical location could be, our MacGuffin could be in a castle, but our castle could be on an island of undead.
Yes, it could be.
Right? So there's like the area outside of the box,
mm-hmm.
right? Like that's setting. And then there's what, there's like, there is where the actual MacGuffin is located.
So can I ask you a question?
Sure.
based on that definition. I just think this is interesting.
Yeah.
Does that mean the dungeon crawl, if you know what you're going in there to look for, is a heist?
I think let's dig into playstyle, and I think I can argue for both, yes and no.
Sure. Okay.
I think it can be done as one, but I'll tell you why I think dungeon crawl often misses the mark.
Okay. So should we move on to playstyle, or are we still talking about setting?
No, I think that's... So if we contrast this to when we talked about two-fisted action,
mm-hmm.
this doesn't really have a prescribed setting, right? Like, there's the box. So the MacGuffin is somewhere.
Yeah.
And that's really it. Like, it's cool to make that more interesting.
Yeah.
But there aren't, like, a whole bunch of different types of settings.
Okay.
Okay, so yeah, so setting is very simple, the box. Now let's talk about playstyle. All
right. So the people that are on the team or on the crew, they're always hyper competent.
Hyper competency is probably one of the hallmarks of the heist.
One of the hallmark tropes of the heist.
Absolutely. And what we mean by hyper competency is that everybody who is participating in the heist is an expert,
mm-hmm.
and they do their stuff perfectly.
Yeah.
So, you know, if we look at Ocean's 11, right? So we've got Danny Ocean. Mm-hmm. He's, you know, the consummate grifter.
Yes.
And kind of the network guy, because he's the kind of guy who bridges everyone together.
Also a mastermind.
Yes. He's got the plan.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we look at the two brothers with the remotes.
They're the physical tech guys.
Yeah. And then you've got Basher with his explosives.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, all the way down. So they're all very competent. And when we talk about doing heists and role-playing games, this is one of the really tricky parts, is hyper-competency. And how, because it's easy to do in TV and in fiction, right? If I was writing a heist, hyper-competency is very easy to do, because I can show it, right?
Yeah, I always felt the leverage role-playing game did a really good job of it.
Yes, some games do an exceptional job of this. Mm-hmm. Other games, when you try to emulate heists, have problems with hyper-competency. So we'll talk about that. Okay, the twist.
So it's a thing that you've planned your heist out, you're starting to execute it, and then there's that thing, not a failure that or a complication to a failure or things like that, but the thing that happens that you're not expecting.
Right.
It's like when the insurance agent guy on Leverage, whose name is slipping my mind, shows up.
Yes.
Because every time he shows up, it's like the worst twist ever for the team.
Yeah. And in Ocean's 11, the twist is Basher is planning to knock out the power. And he goes down to scout it, and he finds the electricians down there looking at it. And then they know about the weakness in the power grid.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when they have to go get the pinch, the EMP.
Yeah.
So that's the twist. That's one of the twists. Because mm-hmm. there's actually, you can have more than one twist.
That's true.
And to that, twists are kind of like a spice, right? Like, it's good to have a twist or two. But you don't want to saturate your game.
Yeah, if your game is all about twists, it's a problem.
Yeah, because the twist plays against hyper-competency, because it requires the hyper-competent characters to deal with the twist.
That's true.
And it gets unrealistic if it just keeps twisting every 10 minutes.
I don't think it messes with the hyper-competence, it just messes with the flow, the beats.
Yeah.
Right? Because part of being hyper-competent is that you have a plan that you can execute well.
Oh, we'll talk about that.
Okay.
Yep. The plan is coming up.
We will. Yes. I just that.
How about we just do the plan?
Yeah, do the plan. That's a good transition to the plan.
Right. So the plan, in a heist, you don't just run in. It's not a smash and grab.
Correct.
So the plan is always the thing that the mastermind and the crew come up with for how they are going to get the MacGuffin.
Mm-hmm.
And the best heists have these really cool, elaborate plans. Like, they're really slick. And we'll talk about some of the things that kind of go into those plans.
Yeah, but that doesn't really function very well at the role-playing game level.
Yes, we'll talk about that, because that's a challenge.
Yeah, because then you have to invent mechanics to help with that.
Yes, indeed.
Like the flashback.
The flashback, yes.
Yeah, we'll get to it.
Yeah, we'll get to it. The double cross.
That's the Italian job, right?
Yeah.
That whole movie is predicated on the double cross.
Yeah, that's when somebody on the team has a different plan than the rest of the crew.
Yeah, and when in Leverage, it's whenever the first time that they run into the evil adventuring party, basically,
yes.
And Will Wheaton's chaos is the double cross.
Yeah, and in Shadowrun, if we're talking about role-playing games, the common trope in Shadowrun is that your employer screws you
over.
Yeah,
Mr. Johnson's going to, yeah.
Yeah, he's
going to
double-cross you. Okay. Let's talk about contingencies.
So that's the being able to modify the plan on the fly when you need to, or having backup plans.
That's the counter to the twist.
Yeah.
Right? The twist occurs, and if we're watching it on a TV show, the twist looks like, oh, they're screwed. But the mastermind already kind of knew the twist was coming,
mm-hmm.
and has the contingency.
So that happens in like Ocean's 11 and things like that.
Oh.
It's not a very common trope in Leverage all the time. Sometimes there's a flashback.
Oh, no, it is.
That's where the flashback comes up, but often Nate will spin that.
Well, the contingency is in Leverage, the show. The contingency is portrayed by the flashback.
Correct.
Because you're basically seeing, like, they got away with it, and then they flash back to show you, like, here's the thing that they already put in place.
Yeah, but there's the other time that they use a contingency is where Nate scrambles to come up with a plan.
Yes.
When things go wrong, or when somebody else, when Sophie does something that needs to be done because Nate gets in trouble, or when Hardison does the thing that you need to do. Yeah. I will use Leverage as the example all the time. Oh, I've seen every episode 5 times
it's
now.
It's so good.
So.
It's so good.
Yeah.
It's so much ample material.
Yep.
Okay. Timing.
Yeah, like everybody has to be working together in concert.
Yeah. Again, a challenge sometimes in role-playing games. Mm-hmm. Subversion.
Yes. Yeah, that's... why don't you tell me about Subversion?
Subversion. Okay. So Subversion is when the crew takes over some part of the opposition's resources. So, for instance, in Ocean's 11... very early on, they subvert the security system,
mm-hmm.
right? So they take over all the cameras and they actually use the looped footage to help steal from the vault.
Yeah.
Right. So they subvert the opposition's resources.
Or when Sophie walks in during the wine episode and becomes part of the staff so she can gain the trust of somebody.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? That's another kind of subversion.
Yeah, disguises, mm-hmm. right? So you disguise yourself as part of
Anytime Hardison goes in and becomes part of the team or whatever. Not the team, but the people that they're trying to rob.
Anytime Hardison hacks anything.
Yeah, that too, because he's taking over their system.
Hack is subversion.
Yep.
Okay. And then the next one, the last one I have on the list is Second World. And so this is not very different from what we see like in urban fantasy. But in a lot of heist stories... there is like a world of crime,
mm-hmm.
right? Criminals know each other. They have reputations. They're aware of each other. There's a code
yes.
between criminals. Like you see that, I think in Leverage, you see that a lot with, what's his face? The hitter.
Yeah.
Like somebody recognizes him.
Mm-hmm.
Like
that's Elliot.
Yeah.
Oh,
like
oh boy.
Elliot, like somebody recognized, like, oh, you did a job in Kosovo or something.
Yeah.
You know, and he's like, yeah.
Yeah, I did.
So there's that second world where criminals live in our world, but there's a world underneath that is about crime and how things get fenced and how you get equipment to subvert security systems and fences and all that stuff.
Yeah,
like there's an ecosystem.
Yep, and that's how everybody knows everybody.
Exactly.
By reputation, by name, by what they've done.
Yeah, like if we look at, so if we talk about Cyberpunk and we look at, because Neuromancer is a heist story.
It is.
It is a very elaborate heist story. Case and Molly move through that second world.
They do. You quite know, a bit, in fact.
Yeah, I mean, they hook up with the Panther Moderns to make the attack on SenseNet. And mm-hmm.
Even before that, Molly uses some of her contacts to have Case scan to see if those bomb things are actually real or not.
Exactly.
Yeah,
yeah. So Second World is a definitely a part of that genre.
So these aren't necessarily playstyles. These are elements these are essential elements, not even essential, but they are elements of the genre that you can bring to
play. Yeah, I think I
kind of
drifted over. I started with hypercompetence and I started kind of drifting into those core elements.
Yeah, I mean, well, hypercompetence is an element of the characters.
It's also a playstyle.
Yeah, that is a playstyle.
Yeah.
The rest of them aren't playstyles.
Yeah, it's probably not the best.
Okay.
It's probably not the best label.
That's
for
fine.
It. Okay.
But I think the first thing is hypercompetence is important for every character that is playing.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it doesn't really feel like a heist
exactly.
game. If the game that you're going for is a heist game.
Exactly.
Now, you could have... if you're going to play comedically, you could have everybody not necessarily be hyper competent, and you have something that's more like a fiasco.
Yeah, and that's not a heist, right? Like, that is a fiasco.
It's a fiasco, but it's attempting to be a heist, right?
Right, which is fine. In fact, there is actually a playset for Fiasco that is a bank robbery.
It sure is.
Right, which then goes completely south.
Mm-hmm.
To that, something like...
So now that's a playstyle.
Right. Reservoir Dogs is a heist gone bad.
It's the end of the heist, right?
Yeah, it's act three of a very poorly executed heist.
Mm-hmm. So if you played it out from the beginning, it would go that way.
Yeah. And that would by all means be some sort of fiasco.
Yes.
Yeah.
So that is a playstyle for heist. That,
yeah.
Yep. Okay.
So we want to pause for a second?
Yeah, what's going on in the chat room?
Lively group again, as usual.
Okay, Bob, I have a first question.
Yes.
How is the chat room working for everybody so far?
So far, everybody is enjoying it. There's some sporadic issues. A couple people are having some issues where it's getting choppy, or it's a bit of a lag, and then it quick catches up and some stuff like that.
Okay.
It depends. It's varying. There are probably reasons for each individual's. Jim is having problems because his family is watching Netflix streaming.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So
I could probably reduce the resolution in the future. All right, cool.
I'm thinking that full HD, 1080.
I took it down.
Oh, you took
it down? I took it down half of that.
Okay, because I'm thinking maybe, you know, go with a 720 next time. But
I will try that.
I don't know. In any event, that's all working pretty good. And I'm a little far from the mic, apparently, again, because I'm bad at that, but I get better. So here's some of the things. Victor Wyatt said that there's an awesome bit about planning out a dungeon in John Wick's Play Dirty. The players make the dungeon and they give the GM resources to change it while they play, quote unquote, some years later.
Yep.
I've seen that.
He also did that section as a YouTube video.
He did.
Which Victor
yes.
linked for us in the Misdirected Mark community.
Oh, very nice.
It's quite good. I think we've actually played it years ago. I watched that video and actually did
I would
something
not
like,
be surprised yeah. if we did. I've read that book, but I don't remember that because it's been a long time since I read it. But we have a person in the chat room called Firestorm Inc. who said, I would like to throw out that Blowback does hyper competency in an amazing way too. And PK Sullivan agreed with that.
Yes.
I own Blowback. I haven't read it.
I think I own it as well, and I have not played it.
There's a chart thing in the back of that game, which is pretty brilliant that I've it's been a while since I studied it, but it's like how you take actions affects things. Yeah. It's pretty good.
Actually,
so.
You know what other game does hyper competency fairly well?
Huh.
Knights Black Ages.
Sure does.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Gumshoe is a hyper competency game.
At some point, most spy movies have a heist component to them.
Yes. Because ultimately at some point you're stealing something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And PK Sullivan said use retroactive awesomeness to make your characters hyper competent.
Yes.
Which a bunch of people agreed with.
And we can talk about that. When we get into what makes a good heist in RPGs, we can kind of talk about the retcon flashback kind of mechanic.
All right. So are we all caught up?
We are caught up.
All right. I think now it's time to talk about the kinds of characters that you find in heists.
Yes.
And everyone, if you feel the need to comment or let us know what we miss, please do in the chat room for life.
Yeah, and inevitably, I have missed something in this list.
Yeah.
But I tried real hard.
So here's my favorite one.
Go ahead.
The Mastermind.
Oh, man, I love the Mastermind.
I do love me some masterminding this.
Now, I know you like Nate as a mastermind.
Yeah, but I also like Danny.
Danny. Can I tell you one of my favorite masterminds?
Sure.
Hans Gruber.
Yeah, it's a good one.
Hans Gruber is the moment, and here I am, okay? So I'm a teenager watching Die Hard in the movie theater. Some people on the chat room may not have seen Die Hard. Just going to say that, put that out there. I'm watching Die Hard, and that moment in the movie where the FBI cuts the power and Hans turns to the hacker,
mm-hmm.
and he's like,
Theo,
the circuits that can't be cut
are cut automatically in response to a terrorist threat.
Right. And so the vault, you know, the music comes up and the you know, the vault starts opening, the light shines on them. Like at that moment, I'm like, Hans Gruber is my ultimate bad guy.
Oh, that's great.
Like because that's a heist, right? What the bad guys are doing in Die Hard is a heist.
Yeah, absolutely.
They're stealing $600 million in negotiable bearer bonds.
It's just that happens that John McClane ends up in the building and kills them all.
That's the twist. Yeah.
They don't deal well with the twist.
No. In fact, and their contingencies all go to hell, right?
Yeah, because he just screws them up one after another.
Exactly. So, but yeah, like that's one of my favorite masterminds is Hans Gruber. Okay. I think we covered the mastermind is the person who has the plan.
Yep.
They're also the person that often has the contingency.
Correct.
Okay. The hacker. Now, I use this in a broad term because when I say hacker, we're instantly thinking of our computer-based characters, right? Mm-hmm. So we're, you know, Hardison.
Yeah.
Hardison's like the consummate hacker, right?
Correct.
I love Hardison. Mm-hmm. But if we were doing this in fantasy, our mage is the hacker.
That is true, because they're the one that hacks their way past magical problems.
Yeah.
In fact, I often use magic that way in my D&D games.
Yeah, like if you're doing a heist in Ebron, the hacker is the wizard.
That's right.
Yeah. So anyway, I define the hacker as the one who kind of works their magic, right? Mm-hmm. Because the things that Hardison does to a security system feel magical.
They're
right?
A little
like
magical.
Doors unlock like a knock spell. He can see in places like wizard eye.
So yeah. Really what the hacker is the person who uses the technology of the setting to do things.
Yes.
Especially to overcome obstacles that are in the way.
Yes.
And also allow people access to places they wouldn't normally be able to get to.
Yeah. Like a wizard.
Like a wizard.
Yeah. And I mean, of course, if we're talking about Shadowrun or Cyberpunk 2020, the hacker is a quintessential piece of that game.
Now they just need to make rules that go with it well.
Oh.
We can get to that later.
Let's not get in there.
So tell me about deceiving people and taking on characters.
This
and
is probably my next favorite.
This is my second favorite, too.
The Grifter.
I wish I was a better liar.
Oh, the Grifter is... when done well, the Grifter is so much fun. So in Leverage, we're talking about Sophie. We're talking about Danny Ocean, mm-hmm. Rusty.
Yep.
Like, those are all Grifters. And they're so just, they're cool, right? That's like, that's the hallmark of the Grifter. The Grifter is cool. Right?
Yep.
And they, you know, they can use disguise. They can use social manipulation, all that stuff to get you to do things that you wouldn't normally do.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Next, how about if we have to get violent?
Then you need Elliot.
You need Elliot, the hitter.
Mm-hmm. Or James Bond.
The shooter. The hitter, the shooter. We need the person who's going to do some violence.
Yeah, that's why I said James Bond.
Yes.
Because he's a terrible spy.
He is a terrible spy. First of all, he just keeps using his own name.
That's true.
He's a right? blunt instrument.
That's true.
Yeah.
He's totally a hitter.
Yeah. And so, yeah, the hitter
That man needs to be reined in.
Inevitably, I shouldn't say inevitably, a heist could easily go off without any violence.
Mm-hmm.
But since we often like violence in our video, in our role-playing games and in our
video games and TVs and movies, because we're Americans.
Yeah, sometimes you got to punch something. Solve a problem by punching it in the face.
That's right.
And that is what the hitter's for.
That's true.
Okay. How about the driver?
Yeah, the driver. This is interesting because it's a very niche role.
It is. If you want to have... Well... It's a niche role unless you're playing Fast and Furious.
That's true. Then everybody needs to be a driver.
Yeah, driver slash
those
something.
Are wonderful heist movies.
Yeah. So
by the way,
the driver.
If we want to fight about it, chat room or anybody else, we can fight about how good or bad the Fast and the Furious movies are because I love those movies.
I am perfectly fine with that. But you know what? It occurs to me that is a script that is not in action movie world.
It's true.
The Fast and Furious.
Yeah.
I feel like we're going to need to do some hacking.
Yeah, we might need to,
anyway,
might need to
put do a that. Pin, put a pin in that.
By the way, there's not a single grifter in that crew.
No, no, no. That's not a... Fast and Furious is not about grifting.
Well, there's one. I forget his
name.
It's
about driving cars on top of airplanes and shit.
Like. Yeah, true. Or through or across through buildings into other buildings. Yeah.
Yes. Which is fine.
Yeah.
It's ridiculously fun and fine. Okay, so the driver. I also thought, but I don't think it's actually a heist movie. But I mean, when I think driver, I often think the transporter.
Yes, but that's not a heist movie.
It's not a heist movie. But, you know. Oh, but Handsome Rob.
Handsome Rob.
Handsome Rob drives. Oh, and The Italian Job. There's a whole
it's driving totally about
element
driving.
Of that movie.
It's one of the best chase scenes ever written.
The Mini
never
Cooper.
Never filmed, I should say, yeah.
That's when I fell in love with Mini Coopers. That's why I still want one. The Patron.
So that's the person who's giving you money to do things.
Yeah, because sometimes stealing shit is expensive.
It sure is.
Like sometimes you need a backer.
Usually, if you're the patron, is just an NPC.
Yeah, it's often not a character.
Yeah,
but you will see them in the background. They can also be the double cross.
They could.
Your patron could be the one who screws you, the Mr. Johnson.
So we're getting away a little bit. Well, you didn't put the thief in there.
Did I not? Well, that's fine. I thought I did, but okay.
I don't see a thief.
No, I don't either. The thief.
Yeah, there's the thief. That's Parker.
That's Parker, who actually goes in and picks locks and opens safes.
Also known as the Grease Man.
Yeah.
The little Chinese guy in the Ocean movies.
Yes. So fantastic.
Yeah. So there's that.
The Mark.
The person that you're stealing from. That is... I forget his name in Oceans.
Oh, Andy Garcia's character.
Andy Garcia's character. Yes. Or in 13, it's Al Pacino.
Terry Benedict.
Terry Benedict. Oh, Bob's on tonight,
Very
man.
Very nice.
I'm always on.
Yeah, I mean, it's the coffee. You should always have
no,
a coffee.
No, it's not the coffee.
My in every episode of Lever, it's always some scumbag, white-collar person.
Oh, well, I mean,
90%
of the
time.
That's the premise of the show. Yeah. Right? Or it's sometimes an underworld figure or something
that,
like
too.
That.
There's actually a whole season where they're trying to get a hold of an underworld figure, and they do it by stealing an election.
Yep.
So they can extradite somebody. It's interesting.
Oh, yeah, I remember that. It's good. Yeah. The Contact. So often these are NPCs that the crew rely upon. So this could be a fence. This could be somebody who supplies your high-tech thieving gear.
Mm-hmm.
If it's fantasy, it could be like the wizard who sets you up with some magical gear.
Yeah, yeah.
But the contact often is either providing some sort of resource, be it information or gear.
Yeah.
The lieutenant.
So they're somebody who's working with the Mark.
Yeah, and often
they end up being a problem for the crew.
Often the lieutenant is something is often the character that punches things. If the Mark themselves aren't punching things in the face, mm-hmm. then it's the lieutenant's job.
I always like the lieutenant who's clever.
I do too.
That would be the I always forget his name. The insurance agent, the guy who's in like everything. He's Badger and Firefly.
Yes.
And
I
forget his name though. You want to look that up for me, buddy?
Oh yeah.
In Die Hard,
Crowley.
In Die Hard,
Crowley and Supernatural. Sorry.
In Die Hard, it's Alexander Goodenough.
Yes.
What is it? Tell Carl. Carl. Tell mm-hmm. Carl his brother is dead.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Hans Gruber is, in his John Phillips suit, and he's very slick, and he's very well spoken.
Wayne got it for me. It's James Sterling.
Sterling. Yes. Excellent.
Yes.
And the actor's name is Mark Shepard.
There we go.
Okay. So lieutenant is often, at some point, the lieutenant has to be dealt with.
Mm-hmm.
And that's usually like because a lot of times in heists, you don't actually touch the Mark.
Correct.
So the lieutenant is basically what the team winds up as the main opposition.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Unless, of course, the grifter is going in and grifting the Mark.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, often if everything goes well, the grifter has done something and the Mark gets in trouble.
Yeah.
Yeah. The security system.
The Starenko.
Yeah, the security system is without a doubt a character.
Absolutely. I feel like it should be. It is most of the time in, it's the safe. The safe always has a name.
It's the main opposition. I mean, if you look at Ocean's 11... That scene when they're all in the house and Rusty's going through the whole thing, you know, it's buried below the floors. It's got ground sensors all around it. It requires a thumbprint. Yeah. No, we can't tunnel underneath it. Ground sensors will pick it up. Anyway, that thing's a character because it is the thing that ultimately the crew is fighting.
Yep.
So... the more interesting the security system is, I think, and we'll talk about it when we get to what makes a good heist in a role-playing game, but you should think of the security system as a character.
Absolutely.
Yeah. The new guy.
Hopefully it's not a player character.
So the new guy is somebody who's brought onto the team at the last minute.
Or girl, by the way.
Of course.
Mark, my apologies.
Gal. Person.
There you go. Thank you. For instance, that is Matt Damon's character in Ocean's 11.
Yes.
They weren't planning on having him, and they brought him in the last minute.
Mm-hmm.
The new guy is also sometimes has a second role, which is the loose cannon.
Well, that's... Well, which guy on the A-team is the loose cannon? The crazy guy?
Murdoch,
yeah.
So Murdoch is the loose cannon, but he's good. And in Heat... If you remember the opening heist in Heat when they rob the armor car,
mm-hmm.
they pick up that ex-con.
Yeah.
And he just starts shooting everyone.
Yeah.
So he's the new guy and the loose cannon.
Yep.
Like, they plan on killing him after that job. They take him out into the parking lot, and they've got the trunk lined with garbage bags.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they're going to put a bullet in him, stuff him in there, and walk him away.
Mm-hmm.
But he gets away. But,
yeah.
So that's a case where the new guy is also the loose cannon.
But the loose cannon doesn't have to be the new guy.
No, no, not at all. In fact, actually, I'm glad you brought up Murdoch because that's a great case where the loose cannon is part of the crew, an integral part of the crew.
Yeah, and in Reservoir Dogs, I forget the guy.
Huh. Yeah, Mr. Blonde.
Mr. Blonde.
Yeah, yeah. That's a bad loose cannon.
Yeah, that's a bad loose cannon. Yeah,
Michael Madsen's character.
Then there's law enforcement.
So because the Mark isn't necessarily part of law enforcement,
mm-hmm.
or may be a criminal and not necessarily, does not always have the benefits of it.
True.
Law enforcement is another thing that kind of circles that second world.
Yeah, it's true.
So that can be the case where you're planning the heist and some FBI agent recognizes you.
Yeah.
Like separate. Like that's just a complication.
Mm-hmm. Or the police are around. Or a detective is looking into your case.
Well, you speed away from the crime scene.
Somebody gets your license plate.
And now the cops are on your tail as well.
There's that. That can actually happen.
Yeah.
There can be a character who is law enforcement that's part of the crew.
Yes.
That happens also.
Yeah. That's fun. That's subversion, right?
That is subversion. That is Fast and the Furious, because Paul Walker.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Is a cop. Essentially, he's actually working undercover.
I always forget that.
Well, it's because he's got divided. That's his
loyalties.
His divided loyalties. That's his character arc for that movie, and even going on. Like, I'm a cop. Do I want to be in this life that I really want to be in, or do I want to keep being a cop?
See that second world thing.
Yep.
Fast and Furious does a good job with that second world.
It does. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's all about that world behind that world behind the world.
Yeah. Like, I actually love
street
that.
Racing and stuff.
For the same reason you love it in urban fantasy.
Yeah.
Like I love
that's why I love that movie, those movies.
Right. In all manner of crime drama. So mob movies, criminal procedural things, and in heists, I love the criminal second world.
Mm-hmm.
I love that world of crime. Okay.
So Phil,
how do we actually put this together in a role-playing game?
Yes, because this is your baby. This is your shtick.
This is my baby. How do you do it well?
You, in fact, ran a whole campaign based on heists.
I did, and
using a game system that I would not have used.
A substandard game system.
Yeah.
Yes. Not substandard. Not optimized for this.
Substandard for heists.
Substandard for heists. I wouldn't do that system again for heist.
Yeah.
What Chris is referring to is I actually had a campaign many, many, many years ago. That was in D20 Modern,
mm-hmm.
that we did, that we actually called Heist, and it was about a crew that operated out of Las Vegas in the turn of the 21st century, right? It was 1999, 2000 kind of thing.
Yeah, I think so.
It was like, it was on the heels of Ocean's 11.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we were totally digging that that whole vibe. And so, yeah, we did a whole campaign. It was a year long. Bob was actually the hacker.
Yep.
We actually had a Sean Gilgore, who I think is in the chat room tonight, it was the mastermind grifter.
Yep.
And we had a hitter. I was the shooter driver
because
we didn't need him very much. And then we had another grifter because we had a disguise guy. Jay's character.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, so how do you do this well in an RPG? Here's the hard part. We said it at the beginning. Hyper competency is one of the hallmarks of this of the genre.
Yeah.
So D20 does not do hyper competency well.
No.
There's too much randomness
in
the D20 system.
Because the D20 is a line.
Yeah.
Like, it's not a curve. It's not a bell curve or anything like that.
No, it's all over the place. So hyper competency, you're going to have to do one of two things. You're either going to have to find a game system that emulates hyper competency through the rules. The leverage role-playing game being a phenomenal version of that.
It does it really well because of some of the other things that go along with it.
Yes. Fate. Because Fate characters are competent and proactive.
Yes.
So it actually does that pretty well because your +4 stat is going to always average about +4. Your use of Fate points will be able to keep you in high numbers and rerolls.
I'm thinking about that D20 thing. Because the D20 is a bad mechanic for it, right?
Yeah.
So you have to mitigate the D20 roll. And you do that by introducing a secondary currency to use to be hyper-competent at a thing. Or feat packages
now,
that
luckily,
make you hyper-competent because it's D20.
Luckily in
and skill D20, point allocations.
D20 had an action point system.
It did.
So that helped.
Mm-hmm.
But it didn't emulate hyper-competency. Like,
You know what emulated hypercompetency in that? I'm just going to armchair design for a second.
Dude,
so the action point was allowed you to roll an extra d6, right? Now, you should have picked a roll of some sort. So when you did something with that roll, you could roll either a higher die or multiple dice and take the highest of those dice.
That's pretty badass.
Yeah, that would have made that more. That would have made you feel more hyper confident at your thing.
Yeah, and you could have tacked that to a feat or a class power or something like that.
Yeah, because that would have fixed some of that problem, because you're trying to design for a universal system at that point.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So hyper competency is a thing that you have to figure out how it's going to work in your game. You have to decide, do my rules do hypercompetency, or am I going to have to work my way around it? And by work my way around it, one of the tools you can use, no matter what game system it is deciding when to make the characters make a skill check or not.
True.
Like, you might just say, like, when they go to scout the computer system, you might just give them the information.
True.
You have 12 ranks in computers. This is what you find.
Yes.
You're hypercompetent.
Absolutely.
That's why Gumshoe.
Well, yeah, you're spending points, right?
Gumshoe's really good at this,
right? In fact, you don't even have to spend points to get certain things.
Your investigative skills, which is all your setup.
Mm-hmm.
And here's why Knights Black Agents is perfect. You have the investigative skills. You have that preparedness skill for your contingencies,
mm-hmm.
right? Because you can spend points and just say, oh, I have a rocket launcher.
Yeah.
And you have the contacts pool so that you instantly know a person. Mm-hmm. Who can help you with get a car, whatever information or material you need.
Yeah.
And when you pull that together with a couple of characters, that is really hyper competent.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So that is a really, now that I'm thinking about it, while that is a thing you can do in Knights Black Agents, those rules might be ideal to run a heist campaign.
They probably would be.
Yeah. I mean, you just got to knock a few skills out, and you don't need the vampirology or, occultism and stuff like that. You just swap those out for a couple of
Well, you skills. Just you just write in whatever the heist skills are.
Yeah, be very, very easy.
Yeah.
Hmm.
I'm just thinking about leverage, like, because leverage does it a very specific way. One, it's just got the five rolls.
Yep.
So, and then you assign dice to those rolls. So you can actually be pretty, and everybody's pretty competent anyway, unless they're rolling D4s, because it's just you build your dice, pull your roll, and you're trying to generally either beat target numbers or hit or be better than opposed target numbers by, you can spend points to create advantages and things like that. It's very fate-like.
I'm going to jump in. I'm watching the chat room roll by.
I was just going to say.
And we'll get to that. One second.
They're actually asking questions about hypercompetence.
Yeah, as soon as I'm done with leverage. The thing that makes, I think, aside from some of that other stuff that we just talked about with the plot points for, it's got a mechanic to basically mitigate that stuff. You can add more dice, up dice.
Yep.
You can basically build advantages like you do in Fate, like create an advantage.
Exactly.
And it's got the flashback mechanic, which also makes you hyper-competent.
Right, because the flashback mechanic corrects problems.
Correct.
Yeah. It handles the twist, and it corrects if you screw up a roll.
Yeah. So what are the people asking about hyper-competence?
Ermaine, our friend Jim, had a really good question. So is hyper-competency a fiction trope, or is it really required to game the heist?
It's required because what is a role-playing game if not emulating a specific thing? So if you can't be hyper-competent in the game, then you're not actually playing that kind of game.
Right, because there's a difference between, so let's be clear, there's a difference between a heist story and stealing shit.
Yes.
And hyper-competency, I think, is one of the tropes that separates those two.
Yes.
Because, and let's just use D&D as an example. I could run a heist in Sharn, okay, mm-hmm. where a hyper-competent group of a mage, a thief, a fighter, and, I don't know, somebody else, break into a tower in Sharn and steal a magical artifact.
Yeah.
Okay? If I do that with hyper-competency, I can make it feel very much like a heist. I could also, and this now goes to your question at the beginning of the segment, I could just run it like a straight up D&D adventure where it's, hey, on the third floor of this building, there is this magical artifact. You are standing out in front of the door. Proceed.
Mm-hmm.
And we could just play it like D&D.
Yeah, go into the tower and do whatever you
kill your way up to the top and take their shit.
Mm-hmm.
That is not a heist.
No.
You just took some shit from something you killed.
You killed a bunch of stuff and took, you killed a bunch of things and took their stuff.
Yeah. So hyper competency to me is a key trait of the heist genre. Think that's fair?
I think that is right.
Okay.
I'm trying to Jim's point, I think, like I said before, like, hyper competency is a trope of heist stories, but role-playing games seek to emulate tropes of stories. Like,
yes.
To me, that is what a role-playing game is actually setting out to do most of the time, and that's give you the tools to emulate the kind of stories that we like to like to create.
Yeah, and in fact, when a heist kind of falls flat,
it's because it didn't do that well.
It doesn't because it did because the mechanics didn't do hyper competency well, and so people were talking about Shadowrun. But one of the things about Shadowrun is, and I've seen this, somebody actually posted this meme somewhere, 3 hours of planning, and ultimately we just kick in the door and start shooting shit. Like, because you're not hyper-competent in Shadowrun. You're rolling on a dice pool, and inevitably, somebody botches it.
Yeah.
And all hell breaks loose.
Yep.
Now, there's another thing with, like, planning for a heist. A lot of, why don't you just continue on with the list, and I'll get to that later.
No, that's fine. All right, so we talked about, we talked about hyper-competency.
Mm-hmm.
We want the players to feel hyper-competent.
Yes. And we just talked about a whole bunch of mechanics for ways to do that.
Yes. We need to make sure that we actually have all the four main parts of the heist.
Most of the mechanics, just to break down what we said, they either need to let you do a thing or they need to give you ways to mitigate failure.
Yeah, fix a thing when it went wrong.
Yes.
And in the best ones, actually combine both.
Uh-huh.
Which is why I really like Fate. For this, fate fits
it's,
here.
It's why leverage is so good because it uses a lot of those same rule sets. Those rule sets are not very different from each other.
No, they had a lot of similar designers kind of bleed through on them. Okay, so have the four parts of the heist. Have a MacGuffin.
Mm-hmm.
It's even better if the MacGuffin is something that's something that people are interested in.
Yes.
So it can just be a MacGuffin. It is more interesting when the MacGuffin has meaning.
Yes, when it's either a personal story for somebody or somebody gets personally invested in that story. I mean, by their character gets personally invested in that story. It's something that is actually relevant to their past. There's all those tricks, right?
Yes. The box needs to be interesting.
Yes.
I mean, if it isn't, the heist will be okay. But when we talked about the security system as a character, this is what you want. So in your fantasy game, maybe you're stealing from a necromancer and the necromancer security system is like bound souls and, you know, those kinds of things.
I'm thinking about that. I don't think the box needs to be interesting. I think one of these parts that you're talking about, that you're going to talk about all four of them, one of those needs to be interesting.
I don't think it hurts if the box is interesting. If all you say is like, well, it's in that building over there.
So many leverage episodes don't have an interesting box. But they have interesting opposition.
Okay.
That's why I'm saying that. Some of the boxes are interesting, especially when the Starenko shows up, but the Starenko is technically a character, so that's not even the building.
Right. I'm okay with that. You've made a solid point. I like the box to be... My preference is to make the location very interesting.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, the opposition. Let's make the opposition interesting.
Strange enough, that's where I prefer the thing to be interesting.
Yeah.
Like, then I have interesting characters and interesting opposition to deal, to interact with the characters.
So we just need to Wonder Twin power this thing.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wonder Twins.
Oh, where is it? I don't... Sorry.
Anyway.
You want to telegraph it a little bit more so I can not pay attention?
I'll try again later.
No, you did such a good job. I was bad at that.
That's all right. Have at least one good twist. A heist that goes perfectly according to plan is kind of a yawn.
Yeah.
I mean, it's okay. If the players make all their rolls and they knock it out of the park, give it to them.
Mm-hmm.
But like when I wrote the heist game, when I wrote that campaign and every two sessions was a heist, no matter how well they did gathering intelligence, there was always something that they couldn't know.
Well, there's got to be a twist.
Right. They would get on site and discover that the security guard broke up, had a fight with his wife and was sleeping on the couch next to the safe.
Yeah. When you design the thing, you could almost say, well, these are the discoverable things and here's the one thing that they'll never figure out.
Exactly.
I mean, you can do that. I actually don't think there's a problem with that.
And that's the fun part. Like when that thing is revealed, that's when the players have to scramble a little.
Mm-hmm.
And that just, it's fun. It keeps them on their toes. Okay. Let's see if you agree with this next statement.
Sure.
A good heist is never about if they can get the MacGuffin. It's about how they get the MacGuffin.
Yes.
Okay, good.
Because the whole point is to get the MacGuffin. I mean, I think every once in a while, once in a great while, they don't get it.
Sure. Just for variety.
Yes. But 90% of the time, maybe even 95% of the time, they should probably get the thing that they're trying to steal.
I agree completely.
And the question should be, what does it cost them to do it?
Yeah. And I think it's important because I think that...
Or how do they get it?
How? right? Because
even this isn't really about cost. That's a very specific kind of story for a heist.
I mean, cost is a personal thing.
Yeah.
And that's okay. You can do a dark and gritty heist. Like, what's the personal cost? Do the whole team make it? Does somebody get pinched? That kind of thing.
How much mental anguish do they have to go through to do it?
Yeah. Do they have to actually break their own code and kill somebody?
Yeah.
Yeah. But I like heists being about how, not if.
Yeah.
And that's another thing where D20 doesn't really help you, because D20 is very much about if. Are you going to hit this thing? Are you going to have enough hit points to get by? Am I going to make this roll? It's very much a game of ifs.
Yeah, I get you're not wrong. I just I didn't read D20 Modern.
Sure.
So I don't know.
It's very 3/5.
It's a rule set, right?
Yeah.
Essentially, it's 3/5. Just.
It's a rule set, so it encourages that kind of play in the text, but it never defines failure. It just says failure is that you fail, instead of failure that is fail forward.
Yeah. Correct.
So that's, if you just switch that one thought, then it becomes a completely different game.
Well, look at the inclusion of fail forward in 5th edition.
Yes.
That's a very big deal. Mm. It's a very small rule that has profound impact on the game.
Yes.
Yeah. So fail forward is probably another thing that we should that you can count in hypercompetence.
Yeah.
It helps. It's not hypercompetence, but it makes, like, you can still give a success.
Yeah.
With a cost.
Yep.
Fate does that very well.
Or in the case of a high success with a twist.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. A good heist needs a way to allow for retconning or changes. We talked about that. That's the flashback.
Yeah. I think that is a pretty...
That's very tropey.
You don't need it all the time.
No, but it's cool when it works.
It's cool. Like, it's cool if you have it built into your game, right?
Yeah.
But it doesn't. It's not built into every game.
No.
And taking it and trying to shove it into a game isn't always easy.
Yeah, you will. Your mileage will vary.
Yeah,
But it is cool if you can pull it off. Like, if you do something like, well, you can't spend this action point unless you kind of explain what thing you did.
See, that's cool, right? Yeah, like, you're basically easy. Using the move mechanic of when you trigger the flashback, you can spend the point.
Yeah, the preparedness.
You can spend the point when you trigger the point by having a flashback.
Right, the gumshoe preparedness skill.
Yeah,
that's one where you just say, like, I mean, you get to spend the points.
You have a point, a pool of resources of preparedness. You're prepared to a certain extent. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it makes perfect sense.
And then you just get to do the cool thing where when I spend points from that pool, I just explain how I kind of, you know, knew this was going to happen.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah.
We didn't talk about something.
Which one?
We didn't talk about the plan.
Yeah, the plan.
Because the plan drives me crazy.
So I don't remember if we've talked about it on the show or if I've written about it on G+. The plan can be terrible. Like, it could be a whole show we could do about planning. Like,
yeah.
Why planning is...
I'm not a fan of planning.
No. No, in fact, as a GM, it's boring as hell.
And that's not exactly true, right? Like, I don't mind if people have a plan, but if you're going to have a plan, it needs to be... If you look at the Oceans model, they come up with their plan, but as they're coming up with the plan, the pieces of the plan, they have other scenes of them going and executing on the things that they need to get the plan going.
That is okay.
So that's an interesting structure to use for a game. Like, okay, you can come up with your plan, but every time you come up with something in your plan, you have to go do the thing for that part of the plan.
Here's where the plan,
like,
kind of...
scouting out the location, all that things.
Right. So you've addressed what often makes the plan terrible, which is often the plan in older games and things like that, often the plan is not play. It's the players sitting around arguing about how they're going to do stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And here's the problem. Players, especially in one-shots and things like that, aren't necessarily in sync to be collaborative.
Yeah.
So there is a whole collaborative dynamic that has to be, like, worked on and facilitated by the GM.
Mm-hmm.
Or by another player. But somebody has to make that group productive. Otherwise, planning is excruciating.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you talk about planning tied to action,
yeah,
that's fun. Because mm-hmm. that's saying, well, we need a thing. Okay, let's do a scene about that.
Yeah. There's another thing about planning, too. When you're planning a heist, often people don't realize what you have to do to heist something, to steal something.
Yes.
So the game is about information distribution, right? You need to provide them an entry point. You need to provide them information about the opposition if that's what they're looking for. And when they say, we need to find out about that, then you need to provide them as a game master a way to go action. You need to provide them a way to take action to discover that.
Right.
You need to, and you need to provide them what the MacGuffin is, and then you need to provide them either where it is or a way to find it.
And this is where hypercompetency fails, because sometimes you have a group that makes a plan and they've left an obvious hole, but their characters, the hypercompetent characters, mm-hmm. would never have done that.
Yeah.
Like, the players fail to check for motion sensors. Well, guess what? The thief would always have always checked for motion sensors.
And then you can just use it as a twist, right?
Yeah.
Like, oh, there's motion sensors here that we didn't know about.
Yeah, but when it's one of those things where it's like, well, you failed to say you were checking for motion detectors. Well, your character is more competent of a thief, grifter, or whatever than you are.
Yeah.
So that's part of that emulation thing.
Mm-hmm.
I don't like plans in that it slows down the table. I like intents. Like, we need to break in. We need to get away. We need to get the MacGuffin out of the safe.
Mm-hmm.
And then just play, like, along those intents.
Well, that's Blades in the Dark.
And that's where Blades in the Dark really shines.
It's good.
Blades in the Dark. And when we had John Harper on last year, we had him on in an interview. Mm-hmm. He actually said he hates planning for heists.
So he got rid of it.
He mechanized the plan. And I think Blades in the Dark is a really good example of how you can just kind of not have to worry about that.
Can't wait until it comes out in real.
Yeah. I know you're... So, for listeners who don't know this, Chris and I have the exact same problem when it comes to Kickstarter drafts, which is, I would like to read the book, but since I know it's not finished, I won't read the book.
Yeah, I actually have a huge problem with it. Like, to be honest with everybody, there's only about... we do this, but we're also game designers, so I've picked basically two games to focus down and learn how to design for, which is anything Powered by the Apocalypse and Dungeons and Dragons, because that's where we work primarily.
Right, and I've focused on Fate.
You're the Fate guy.
Yeah.
And I like to read other games, but I can't read four different, five different versions of Blades in the Dark because I start getting the rules confused in my head.
Exactly.
I still play sometimes D&D 5th edition rules with rules from five versions ago.
Yeah, because you played all of the
playtest. Yes, I played all of the playtest.
Yeah, so I'm actually real, like, I get stuck up about that. Like,
Makes me bad, right? Like, cause I want to playtest other people's stuff.
Yeah.
But I'm still learning how to do that.
I can playtest other people's stuff when it's a directed playtest. Like, if I go to a table and somebody's like, hey, we're playtesting this game. Yeah. Here's a character sheet and let's play.
Yeah.
But I won't take the Word document version. Like, for instance, Unbound.
Yeah.
Unbound, they almost, at the end of the Kickstarter, released essentially a PDF version of the Google Doc.
Mm-hmm.
And I got it and I started reading it. I'm like, this is great. I can't wait till it comes out laid out.
We have gone way off track. And it's my fault.
That's okay.
Is there anything else left to say about this topic? Is there anything you'd like to say?
I don't know.
Wrapping
I just want
up?
To scold Bob for not bringing us back on track.
No, that's okay.
I was paying attention to the chat room.
Damn it, Bob.
Bob was doing his job.
Okay. Yeah. How about the chat room before we exit out of this?
Has the chat room stolen anything?
No, they haven't stolen it. Well, they stole the chat room people away from the topic.
Oh, that's about right.
We're kind of diverging to Savage Rifts, and
I heard it just popped up, right?
And Jim McClure just said something that was very interesting.
I might have to take a look at the Savage, download a copy of Savage Rifts.
I will. Yeah.
Avi, welcome to the party.
Oh, welcome. I have to say, I'm still kind of fascinated with Action Movie World. It's kind of stealing my attention right now.
It's interesting.
It's really interesting.
The mechanics are interesting to me from a Powered by the Apocalypse kind of game. Like, oh, this is really doing a good job of emulating what an 80s action movie
is. We'll talk about it later. Yeah. It's so good.
So that's it for Heist then, right?
Tighten this train up.
Oh, well, let's make our getaway then.
All right, we will be right back after this. Or actually, I'm just going to hit this button because, you know, that's what happens when I just, like, make coins up.
It's raining. Hey.
Here, have a diamond. Since you can develop this along. Oh, we're giving you diamonds. We try sometimes. We missed you. We thought you could have some
Did you miss me?
Diamonds, yeah. The first thing up in the extra dimensional social media depository is, have you met Bob?
Have you met Bob? Do we have a topic?
No, we don't. We want to spin one up for me?
Let's spin one up.
The Queen was distressed that you didn't do this at the beginning.
I know, that's why I put it in there.
What can we talk about Bob?
She reminded me. We talked about his game preferences.
You guys talked about his game preferences?
Because we did that 2 weeks ago, didn't we? And last week we talked about things he likes to do other than that. And he talked about reading books. Yes. He's a voracious reader.
He is a voracious reader.
We talked about his job already.
We did. And his evening job.
Yes, his evening job.
Because
he's the eyes.
Bob, let's talk about...
Shouldn't we talk about the bad stuff, too?
Is there really any bad stuff to Bob?
Bob, if you had to say a few things about yourself that are things that you were working on as a human being to be better, what would you say that they are?
Well, that's nice. Ooh. That's a nice way to frame that.
Yeah.
Yeah, Bob, what...
By the way, Bob, that shirt is killer. By the way, everybody,
yes.
Bob is wearing a McAnally's Brown Bottle, Max Brown Ale, Old World Ale. That is a reference to the Dresden Files, for those Dresden Files fans out there. Traditionally brewed since 1313, which means that McAnally's pub is really old.
Yeah.
And Mac is an old, old, old god. I don't know that for sure.
Things about me that, yeah.
Well, you're walking, right? I mean.
Well, yeah, I.
That's a thing you're working on.
Yeah, I'm not an exercise person, and for years I didn't do a damn thing as far as like exercise is concerned.
He is a fast walker, though. Like if you're with him at Gen Con,
I have a wicked pace.
You will have
ridiculous.
Yeah, you will have to rein him in. Like you'll be walking, and then Bob's like 10 feet ahead of you, and you're like,
I have to rein myself in because yeah. I just go.
He's really
if there's no opposition in front of me to slow me down. Yeah, it's
interesting.
So I'll be talking to somebody, and I'll be getting away from. So,
do you have any like bad habits like a gross complete disregard for sleep like me?
No, me? I like sleep. Sleep is important.
I also have complete disregard for sleep.
Yeah.
How's
your organizational skills?
I tend to be a little disorganized. I try.
Do you not see the flaws in your own personality? That's okay if you don't. I'm just curious.
I'm ready to lean in on this.
I get tunnel vision. When I get doing something,
yeah.
When I'm working on a project,
uh-huh.
I will get tunnel vision and everything else starts to drop away.
Do you just get annoyed when people bother you then?
No, I don't get annoyed, but I will lose track of things that I'm supposed to be doing.
Ah.
Like other things.
Other things, yeah.
So you fall down the rabbit hole.
Yeah, and I can't multitask to save my life. Like you can sit and you can write or do stuff while you're watching TV.
You know what? That turns out not to be as true anymore. I'm an aggressive monotasker.
Me too. Yeah.
I do one thing and I just like burst through it and then I go do another thing.
Yeah. But still, you've had times you used to sit and watch TV and it's like I can't listen to a podcast and work on something. That's why I listen to the podcast now while I walk because I'm just walking.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Anything else?
Do you not have
like a sick addiction to like comic and geek stuff?
Well, I don't know about addiction.
Do you have any kind of scary?
I go through cycles where I will like be totally voracious about something.
You should think about that. There'll be a quiz next week about what things you want to do better.
It's like an interview. It's like an interview. Like name your three. What you call it? Your three negative attributes.
Yeah.
You know what? In gaming terms, let's just talk about it. What is your trouble aspect?
Yeah. What is your trouble aspect? God. Besides, I get tunnel focused.
Because that's a pretty good one.
Tunnel vision is probably my big one because that's the one thing that I run into more than anything else.
That's all right.
Chris, what's your trouble aspect?
I can't say no. I'm like, I could do that.
I can do that.
That's actually the name of my trouble.
Do you know what mine is?
Never unprepared.
I thought it used to be that.
It used to be that. It's not. It's I make poor choices.
I make things complicated.
That's what it is.
I make things complicated.
When they're not, sometimes
I make anything I get my hands on, I inevitably make more complicated.
Yeah. All right, so that's Have You Met Bob for this week, everybody.
All right, so we'll work a little more on that. Maybe next time we'll put down the couch, you can lay down, and we can have like a little therapy session.
Here we go.
All right, so here's my origins highlights.
Yeah, let's do it, man. Tell me about
not origins.
Not origins. That's a different convention.
I guess that might be a completely different convention. Oh, so the reg line was quick. We were in it for 5 minutes.
That's fantastic.
Yeah. Apparently people were in it on opening day for like an hour and 10. I'm like, that's even not that bad, really.
No, that's not bad.
Yeah. So the convention, it's large, but not huge. It's not super crowded either. There's a gaming hall and a vendor hall and an RPG area, which there were like 3 floors of RPGs in a hotel that was connected. I liked it quite a bit. I could walk the 11 rows of the vendor hall and hardly ever get bumped by anybody.
That's quite nice. No throngs of people to just have to shoulder through.
Yeah, and there was more people there on Saturday than Friday, because Friday I was walking around, but Saturday, like, it was crowded, but not so crowded that I felt claustrophobic, as I make up words.
Yeah, I've been to Origins a few times. That's one of those things I actually like quite a bit about Origins.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I went with Jen. Yeah. We stayed at the Arcadians.
Yeah, that's nice.
Yeah, who were lovely and had coffee and tea for us every day. That was very kind of them. Thank you very much, John and Paula. I walked the dealer's floor a bit on Friday. I ran into Ken Height. That's when I got... I went back to get your book because I didn't get it at that point. You shouldn't ask me.
Yes. Yeah, it didn't occur to me until I saw on Twitter Pelgrane put out. They were like, oh... Or not Pelgrane. Ken had retweeted like, oh, there's copies of Bubblegum Shoe here. Yeah. And I was like, oh, Chris.
Yeah,
like,
I had to go to the IPR booth to get it.
Yeah, well, because it's an Evil Hat book.
Mm-hmm.
Can I just say, as a quick aside, God, I love Evil Hat books.
I saw you tweeted for them for bricks and mortar type stuff, and they sent you the PDF thing like that.
They were so good about that. But I mean, the book.
Oh, I love it.
Their covers.
It's exactly the same as Fate Core.
Oh, it's so... I was so pleased as soon as I put my hands
on it. I like the layout on the inside, too.
They, one column.
Mm-hmm. One column. It's almost like you could read on a tablet.
Like, not that tablet-hating three-column, El Green.
Don't be
Simon's
like that.
Simon's going to punch me.
Yeah, he probably should. I met him. He's a really nice guy.
He is a nice guy. They hate tablet layout.
And Kat Tobin sold me my copy of the Dracula dossier.
Kat's very nice.
Yes, she is. She is quite nice and lovely also.
Dracula dossier. Did you look in the inside cover?
I did. It might have had my name in it.
Might have had your name in it.
As a contributor.
That's awesome. That's awful nice. Kind
of nice, yeah. What else? I had lunch with Ange and John and Paula and others at Bear Burger.
That's awesome.
It was great. That was quite enjoyable. There's a table selfie of it somewhere.
I believe I saw all the table selfies. Ange, by the way, for the win on table selfies.
Ange for the win on Origins in general. She took like 96 or something pictures. It was ridiculous.
And a table selfie, I think maybe at every table she was at.
I think at every table, which means she played a whole ton of games.
I watched a whole ton of table selfies go by.
Yeah. She's winning the table selfie right now. We'll talk about that later. Actually, I have her in the show notes.
That's all right. Keep going.
I interviewed Jim McClure for his show Talking Tabletop, which I'm pretty sure that episode will never air, and I will never talk about what happened in that room more than this, unless Jim says I can.
Did you guys hug it out?
Did you not hear what I just said?
That's fine. No, it's fine.
Jim McClure can say I can say something. Otherwise, I won't. He's in the chat room.
By all means.
He was in the chat room right now saying, Chris, I did not get a...
It's okay, but no details, he says.
No details. What, I can't say how Jim cried four times?
Well, guess we're getting details.
I'm not giving any more than that. I mean, that happened.
It's fine. For all the times Jim's made us cry on interviews, whatever.
That's true. That night I had dinner with the Mad Wizard at Max and Irma's. It's a restaurant pub kind of place.
I have been to Max and Irma's before, yeah.
Yeah, that was nice. We were just chatting. And then I did a bunch of short-form audio interviews for Down With D&D. I had the Baldwin himself, Dave Crist. I talked to Sean Molly, which, by the way, Sean Molly is fascinating. He is on the team that won the MIT puzzle competition this year.
Yeah, seems that's probably pretty good, right?
Yeah, I mean, he's pretty well off.
You can
see some of that. You can hear some of the stuff in the audio, but he was in a startup that ended up selling that company to somebody else. So they had a bunch of money and, you know, he retired early. And so he just travels around doing escape rooms and puzzles and things like that all over the country.
It's nice.
He told this great story about this one that he did, the best puzzle room that he ever did. And if you want to hear that story, you'll have to tune into Down With D&D.
Perfect.
It even had explosives.
Wow. Nice. Like real explosives?
Like real explosives. It was an escape, that's a pretty elaborate escape room setup.
That's some shit, man.
Yeah. I also talked to Rob Schwab. And chatting with Sean for a bit. So you'll hear all of that.
That's awesome.
On Friday. Saturday, I played a bunch of games all day and ran into people. So I hung out with Tom Flanagan from the Knights of the Night. I played the Duke. He beat me promptly. I played Lanterns with him and Jen.
You then brought Lanterns home.
I did, in fact.
Because I got to play it.
Yeah, I quite like that game.
I actually Bob played quite like that too. Game as well. Yep.
Tiny Epic Kingdoms, which Tom was nice enough to just give me a copy because he kickstarted it and had a couple copies. So we played that. That was fun. I played this game called Caverna,
I know Caverna.
Yeah, it is the sequel to Agricola.
Yeah.
Or Agricola, depending on how you want to pronounce
Agricola,
it.
Agricola, I believe, is the correct.
So I've heard it pronounced so many different ways, I'm not sure.
The Dice Tower calls it Agricola.
Yeah, well, I guess we'll go with that then.
If Tom calls it Agricola, it's Agricola.
Caverna, heavy euro, I quite enjoyed it. I ran into Victor Wyatt and his nephew.
I like Victor has gone back to trimmed beard.
Yeah, I didn't notice him at first.
Yeah.
He's like, Chris, and I'm like... Victor, you don't have the beard.
Yeah, Victor was trending towards Gandalf.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was but then cut it back.
Yeah. Then I got to play a game called Five Tribes. That game is wonderful. We're gonna buy that. So Five Tribes has a Mancala mechanic.
Yep.
So you pick up meeples and you start dropping them on the tiles. Yeah. And you have to match the last meeple you have in your hand to at least one meeple on the tile.
Cool.
That is a legal move. And then you pick up the meeples and then you get to take the meeple action. And there's five different meeple actions because the whatever the colors are, they correspond. I won't go into full detail, but that's kind of how you play the game. And then you also take the tile action. And the game ends when you can't take any more legal moves. And it's just a point salad game. Yeah. There's a bunch of different ways to get points.
It's fine. It's not. I mean, it's that game's supposed to be very, very good. It's very well talked
and
about.
And it got me a Will Wheaton promo genie card because you can get genies in that game.
Nice.
Because it's, you know.
Yeah,
it's,
yeah.
Yeah, it's got a little bit of that Arabian theme going on. I met Michael from the RPG Academy and ran into Walt Chinowski at about the same time. I ran into him earlier, but I also ran into him then. Walt's from Cubicle 7, if you're not aware, and he's also a gnome emeritus. And a couple other gentlemen from Cubicle 7 had an interesting conversation with them about just the work that they've done. Then I played Hanabi with Michael and his friend Mike and Jen. We on the third try on variant number one, we beat it, which variant number one, I'm not exactly sure what the variants are for that game. But the rules that we were playing with were that you can tell it had extra cards in the deck. There was like an extra suit in the deck, I think.
Yeah.
And I'm not, because I played Hanabi a couple times before, but I don't really remember it exactly.
Yeah, I haven't played Hanabi in a while.
So you can tell somebody what color they have, all the cards of one color, all the cards of one number, or you can ask them what they know about their hand.
Yeah.
And I don't know, like, I never knew that was a rule. So I thought maybe that was part of the variant that we were playing with.
I'm not 100%, I'm not really versed in Hanabi, other than I've played it once or twice and I know the game.
Yeah. That day we also had dinner at the North Market.
I love the North
Market. North Market's
man.
Really awesome. Yeah. I like that place
a
lot.
The North Market's like the only place you need to go at Origins.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Did you get Indian?
No, I had sushi.
Oh, the Indian place in North Market is so good.
Yeah, it smelled really good. I was thinking about getting food from there, good. But yeah. Then on Sunday we came home.
And then you came like right over here.
I did come over here.
I was having like a little crisis. Chris was like, I'm on my way. And I was like, I don't really know if I want anyone over. And I was like, I think that's probably a sign that I should probably have people over.
Good call.
Well, you know, here's what happened. So I'm super introverted, which I don't think a lot of people, you know, I mean, I'm more introverted.
It's strange because you're introverted, yet you're a narcissist.
Yeah.
That doesn't make, that's a,
sociopathic narcissist.
As somebody introvert. I know likes to say, dichotomies and people are fascinating.
Yeah. But here's the thing. Two weeks of having to be work Phil is very draining.
It's draining.
That's very draining. Like, it is tough being, being on the show, playing games and stuff like that kind of restores my energy. But 2 weeks of being work Phil was crushing.
Draining. Soul crushing.
It was really, really draining. So, by the time Sunday had come around, I just kind of, I woke up with only a couple spoons and it wasn't getting any better. And you were like, I'm on my way. I'm bringing games. I'm getting Bob. And like, and then we had a couple shots of fire and
yeah, we had a shot of fire.
A shot of fire, yeah. Some coffee and some games. And we fixed another thing in Hydra Hackers.
It'll be fine.
That's actually, I think, part of my problem was I kept trying on Sunday to get behind the keyboard and I couldn't do it. Like, I cleaned my desk and I'm like, okay, now I'm going to work on Hydra Hackers. And I'm like, I'm going to go lay on the couch. Like, I can't do it. So you actually came in and as you were setting up lanterns, we had a quick discussion about Hydra Hackers. And I was like, oh, okay. I know what I have to redesign now.
Yeah.
So thank you.
Not a problem. I'm happy to help. So
Chris and Bob for the win.
Moving on, the weight loss challenge.
Oh man,
number 22, week 23.
I was. Can I tell you? I was terrified this morning.
Yeah.
2 weeks of eating at restaurants and eating on the road. I was like, well, I got the scale out this morning. I'm like, well, I got 2 weeks to try to get back under 20 pounds, right? I got on the scale. I did not gain any. I actually lost a little weight from a couple weeks ago.
Nice.
I was like, nice. I was relieved for starters because I didn't want to lose the challenge. But I think in the last 6 months, I have a better feel for when to stop eating. Like, that has not been a thing that I've really been good about. But I ate stuff when I was out and I didn't finish everything. Like, I would eat to a point and I'd be like,
I'm full.
I'd be like, well, I think I'm done. Like, mm-hmm. I don't think I need to eat any more of whatever this delicious thing is. Except for that Garrett popcorn. Damn you, PK Sullivan.
He's not in the chat room, but
I
he'll
not
hear it.
Only bought it at the airport and took a big bag of it with me to my hotel room, which I then ate over the course of 3 days.
Mm-hmm.
On my way home, I went to the Garrett popcorn thing, got another bag, and brought a bag home with me to have at the house like that weekend.
Yeah, that's funny.
Anyway, damn you, PK Sullivan.
Bob, man, how are you doing?
I am hovering so close. I am at 185.6. I'm up 0.2 pounds from last week. But I'm at that pound and a half mark. That's all I need is roughly a pound and a half. And the last chunk has been, the last few weeks, very, very difficult.
So me, last week I was 253 and a half, actually. This week I'm at 252. Getting there. Close.
Come
so,
on, man.
2 pounds away.
Come on, we can do this.
Gotta keep that Dungeon World book, man.
All you have to do
is survive the bachelor party?
Is survive all the alcohol you're gonna drink at this bachelor party. Plus the food you're gonna eat this weekend.
Yeah, I think I'm gonna eat a little less and just drink a little more. And then die.
It's not gonna help.
I'll just vomit. It's fine.
Go. You're gonna see. You're just gonna go full Roman.
Boot and rally, man.
Yeah, boot and rally. By the way, we're bachelor partying on Saturday.
Yeah.
You and I have plans on Sunday morning.
We're gonna have lunch with Palcom Wayne Chan of the Visionary Comms.
We have already warned Wayne that we could be in some various state of distress.
Yes.
When we arrive for breakfast.
Yeah.
So the rest of the crew, Sean Nicholson.
Yes.
184.5 this morning. He's still 4.5 pounds off his goal of 180, but it's within striking distance. Joe Schwick, he's at 240.1, and he was all weekend, target of 233. David Walker, who, by the way, thanks, David, for posting this, because I didn't. He's the one that posted the weight loss challenge. Yeah. Thanks, man. I've been busy scrambling, trying to catch up from being away from Origins.
Yeah.
His starting weight was 253. His goal weight was 233. His current weight is 231.
Yes.
Yeah, that's another one. PK backtracked a little bit. He's 255 this morning, which means he is actually exactly at his goal.
PK's working out like a fiend.
He's crushing it. He's running. Oh, who else put stuff in there? Anybody? No, that was just the conversation. Everything is just chatting after that. So that's what we got in the weight loss challenge. If you're within striking distance, or if you're just still losing weight, you should just keep on it, because I think we're going to, you know, take a month off for July and then do a back half of the year one.
Oh my God. I'm not, I can't take a month off, but sure.
I mean, just from the weight loss challenge stuff.
Yeah.
I was just going to say, we've reached our goal, because our initial goal, and we flippantly came up with this at New Year's, because we knew we were going to Mexico,
uh-huh,
which was to lose some weight
so we could look good on the beach.
Yeah. But, but here's the thing. Like, we did a good thing.
I think so.
Like, people jumped in with us, and people have lost some weight.
Mm-hmm.
And we should not give that up.
No, we won't. We're going to take a month off, because it's good to take some time off, and then we'll get back to it in August.
And then we're back in at this.
Yes.
I fully agree. I say we're doing something positive. Let's let it roll.
I agree.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. So Matt Martinez, a bunch of thoughts he had while listening to episode 212.
Which one's 212?
You weren't here.
Oh, I don't care.
That's the one where we did 10 topics and people really liked it.
Yeah. That's the one where my crappy hotel internet was so bad I couldn't stream.
Yeah.
I was pissed.
Yeah. So, re-PvP. At KublaCon last month, I played in a Prowlers and Paragons game called Saturday Morning Suicide Squad, which, despite the nifty title, was a bit of a misnomer due to the fact that the PCs were all villains from the Disney Afternoon cartoons, save Duke Igthorn, since Gummy Bears was actually a Saturday morning show. The storyline involved all of us being brought together to stop Maleficent from collecting magical artifacts. I was playing Magicka de Spell, so I figured that she would either A, want the artifacts for herself, or B, want to join forces with a fellow sorceress. I sort of struggled with the idea, since I didn't want to seem like one of those jerk faces who says, "Hey, I'm just playing my character," but I felt like it really made sense. By the end, I did engage in some full-on PvP with the other characters. I didn't get the impression that anyone was upset by it, thankfully, but I'm hoping it wasn't just because they were trying to be polite. Another con game I played was Icons. Since it takes a good amount of inspiration from Fate, I wanted to ask about the way some elements are supposed to work. In one instance, I had a quality Icon's equivalent of an aspect of soul merch. Named because my character's girlfriend built mech suits in which she could fight. At one point during a combat, she was being held hostage as a human shield, and I wanted to spend determination, i.e. a fate point, to use my PC's power to give the villain the quality of fractured arm in order to defuse the situation. The GM said that qualities didn't really work that way, unfortunately. In your opinion, is that something you would have allowed, or do you agree with the GM that it wasn't a valid use of a quality? My problem is I don't know exactly what a quality can do in that game.
Yeah, in Icons, it's a little...
In Fate, you would have had to take an action to create an advantage or something like that.
And then it would have been fine.
Because then you would have just gotten a +2.
Yes.
So you couldn't have actually spent the fate point to do that specific thing, but to give you a bonus to doing the thing.
Yeah.
Basically, that's how that would work.
Yeah, in Fate Core, to be
yes.
precise, in Fate Core, there is an action that creates advantage.
Well, also in Accelerated, too.
Yeah, correct. Yeah. No, you're right. But yeah, it's then very clear. Through that. I actually don't know Icons, but I will quickly plug that there is a bundle of holding for Icons.
Oh, interesting.
That is like a shit ton of Icons material up right now, and I think going out till the end of the month.
Neat. Interesting.
Sorry.
Yeah, I don't, like I said, I don't know how that game works exactly, but the way that it would have worked in Fate, like, you can try to do the thing by taking the action of creating advantage or the attack action, and then if you succeed with enough style, you can... you know, put a boost on them of some sort that would do that. Matt goes on to say, I'd really hoped to get in on a Call of Cthulhu game or two during the convention because, as I may have previously mentioned, my only experience with the game was an attempt at running the Quick Start adventure for 7th edition. I didn't dig it. I found the system to be really dull and flavorless. Also, I found that I don't really care for systems that use a whole mess of skills. I first came to this conclusion after playing a con game of GURPS, especially if there's funky math involved. As such, I found myself puzzled as to how that could be considered a game so many people consider to be that exceptional at capturing the spirit of H.P. Lovecraft's fiction. I figured that maybe if I had a chance to play a game being run by an experienced keeper, it would click for me. Unfortunately, the stupid shuffler system locked me out. So, Call of Cthulhu. The...
BRP.
Some people just don't like BRP, right?
I'm not a big fan of BRP.
I'm fine with it because it looks a lot like the skill list from Knights Black Agents and games like that to me.
Well, I mean,
so
where did that drift over from? Yeah.
Yeah. BRP is percentage-based, right? So, one, you might be actually hyper-competent at something, but it doesn't matter because you could fail. And that's very Cthulhu.
Well, I think that's the Cthulian part, right? Like,
that's part of it, but also the sanity track is wonderful. It just works really well for that game.
I mean, given the choice, I like Trail.
I actually over don't.
Because Trail is very different. Trail is about competency.
A little bit, yeah. I mean...
It's more about cost, right?
Yeah, well, Trail, it's right in the book. When you run into something from the other side, you're in trouble. Just run away.
Yeah.
I mean, it's... A lot of times the stuff in there isn't... Like, none of the stuff in there that's really scary is statted out or anything like that because...
It just
eats you. Like, your stability and your sanity just go away.
Shoggoth eats you.
Yeah. I really still like the Call of Cthulhu rules. As far as old games go, it still really works. Because those characters, you are competent because you can have an 80 in certain things.
Correct.
That makes you hyper-competent in a lot of ways because you barely fail, like, at anything. And the Call of Cthulhu 7th edition rules, they take it even a farther step because they give you... Remember how we talked about mitigating
they for hyper-gun? They give you fail forward, right?
They give you fail forward. Two, they give you a way to reroll the dice.
Oh, it's an escalation.
It's escalation.
Yeah. You could reroll, but it's going to get worse.
Yeah, then the game master will give you a worse outcome if you fail.
That's good. I like that.
There's also a stat called luck where you can take those points and then put them into your roll to succeed.
And just out of idle curiosity, so we talked about Trail, you just talked about Call. How about Tremulous?
Eh.
Eh. I know some people who like it, but... I know some people who've had to do some work to...
It's got...
You've run it before,
it's
right?
Not an investigation game.
No.
Like, it's not a game about that. It's a game about the actual fiction, and I think a lot of people were expecting it to be something else.
So they were expecting more like Powered by the Apocalypse, Call of Cthulhu.
Yeah, but it's not that.
But it's not that.
And it's not even good, I think. This is just my opinion. Like, take it or leave it. I've played Tremulous a few times. I've run it a few times. It's not great. It's not a great game.
Okay.
It doesn't do...
No, it's fine.
It doesn't do what I think it should do.
Just that. I was just, you know, I was just curious. We were talking about those two. I figured I'd throw the third one in there.
That's fine. Yeah. I'm more interested in a game like Lovecraft-esque.
Yeah.
Like, that game looks hot.
Yeah. Soth, man. I just want to play Soth.
Yeah, Soth is like being a terrible person, right? Like, Lovecraft-esque is not that. It's
no,
about,
that's what I like about, I mean, Soth, right? Like, just let's play some terrible people.
Lovecraft-esque is about being a Lovecraftian character in the middle of a Lovecraft story. So, like, you're in trouble. Like, you're a person.
Yeah.
And there's all this cosmic horror around you, and it's nihilistic, and it's terrible. And that's why you play that game. Not because of that. Not because of wanting to be an investigator going crazy while learning information. Which it sort of does that too, but I don't know. Like, if you're going to do HP, it's different than if you're going to do Cthulhu.
Yeah, I get that.
Because there's so many people that wrote in the mythos after HP.
Yes.
So, I mean, I guess I might be getting a little too, getting lost in the weeds there a bit.
That's right.
So, moving on. Speaking of craft. If anyone ever asks which collections of his stories they should read, I always direct them to the three Penguin Classic anthologies edited by S.T. Joshi. They don't include all of his revisions, but they're otherwise fairly complete. Also, they contain excellent endnotes, the way most Penguin Classic editions do. My only complaint, and it's a very minor one, is that the stories aren't placed in the order of when he wrote them.
Can I just tack on to something then?
Sure.
I'm a big fan of Ken Height's book, Toward to Lovecraft.
Yeah.
Which has... an essay written by Ken for each story.
Oh, very nice.
So, like, you can go read the story, and then you can read Ken's essay about it. And then in there, Ken has a section called The Essential Lovecraft, which is like, look, if you're not going to read every Lovecraft story,
mm-hmm.
starting at the top, start reading these, work your way down the list, and after that, if you don't read anything else, you've read enough Lovecraft.
Yeah, he's actually talked about that in other places too. Like that's right. Like, I mean, he's kind of height, so of course he's right. So, yeah.
But I mean, it's really like, if you're new to Lovecraft and are curious, like, what stories should you pick up?
Mm-hmm.
Go look at Ken's list. Like, it's helpful. The essays will be tough because Ken like digs in deep,
mm-hmm.
but that section on how to read it and what to read, it's really sharp. And then after you've read a few, go back and read the essays, because they are actually, you know, they're Ken Height. They're fantastic.
Yeah, anyway. Absolutely. All right. Last but not least, I will add to the chorus of voices urging you to check out Babylon 5. But I will do so with a big caveat. The pilot is garbage, as is the vast majority of the first season. Seriously, it's some really rough going, but it's worth it. Season 2 is a marked improvement, and season 3 and 4 are among some of the best television shows I've ever seen. And lest you think... nostalgia is coloring my opinion. I only watched the series for the first time a few years ago.
I have I watched Babylon 5 when it came out.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't a huge like rabid Babylon guy like I am with Star Trek, but I don't disagree with any of that. I mean, first of all, first seasons of a lot of sci-fi shows are pretty bumpy, but that show got some shit done. Like, it was good. It's worth watching.
I have no opinion.
I actually haven't seen it. I've had multiple people tell me that I need to, though.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's a writer that you particularly like.
It's Straczynski, yeah.
Yeah. So on last episode, we talked a little bit about interpretive dice rolls, because that was one of the 10 rapid-fire topics we talked about. And Raul de la Gaza III, the angelic doctor, he chimed in. He said, other games with interpretive dice, WEG Star Wars, revised and expanded, and Cubicle 7's Doctor Who, which both use just D6s. And he actually posted pictures of where the interpretive dice roll rules were in those particular rule books on the G Plus community.
West End Games.
Yeah, West End Games. The original. I'm trying to remember what was interpretive about
the D6
rolling
pool?
A bunch of D6s.
I'm wondering if by interpretive we mean margin of success.
He posted it. He posted the picture in the G Plus community, so you can actually go look. Okay, next, Rob Whitaker, Sudoku World Building. I've thought about RPG world building as top down or bottom up. I could never decide if I was one or the other because I felt like I did both. Top down while designing a campaign arc, but bottom up while designing individual adventures and for session prep. While playing Sudoku this weekend, I realized that I don't really use either of those techniques. Instead, I take a dozen or so facts about the world I want to run and try to figure out what can't be true based on what is already established. And through play, more world facts are established, which further reduces what can be true elsewhere in the world. Phil, what do you feel about that?
I dig that. I used to be like a...
That's how I do it.
I used to be a top-down world builder. I would say now, if I had a way to describe my world building, I would call it just in time. JIT, just in time. I build the world kind of as I need it. So I build the framework of the world. That's enough to get the players kind of looped in. And then I'll just start building in pieces as they need to come up.
The Eerie Peaks was built exactly this way.
In this just in time kind of?
No, this way. The way that he's describing. It is both. I started with a bunch of things at the top. And then I had a bunch of other things that I knew were kind of true, maybe. And then we started playing.
Yeah. Well, that's kind of an emergent setting building.
Well, just in time.
Just in time, yeah.
But also, like, I had things that already existed. But as we kept defining things, more things became untrue.
Right. I mean, I like, and I think I do this, and I think I probably learned it from you, but I, for my last corporation game, just made the players list, like, give me 10 locations, give me 10 NPCs, whatever. And I just threw them on, like, in a list. Mm-hmm. And I was like, well, as I need a location, I'll source it off this list.
Yep.
Just in time.
Great way to do it.
Yeah.
Angela Murray from Origins, she took so many pictures. And I'm going to put a link in the show notes to her Facebook Origins photo album. She is by far winning the table selfie, the hashtag table selfie hashtag right now.
Yes. There,
I have so many pictures of her because I have a folder of all the table selfies that I've been able to collect.
Are you sorting them? Are you sorting them one shot to
campaign? No, because some of them are board game now.
Oh, yes.
Because
a third competitor has joined the fray.
Red player has entered the game.
That's right. Dun, dun, dun.
If you want to put your hashtag board game table selfies in there, don't worry. I'll recognize what they are because board games don't look the same as role-playing games.
Yay. Unless you get to Hydra Hackers.
That doesn't really count.
Dun, dun, dun.
All right, next thing. Misdirected Mark Beer Competition. Here are a few of the entries that we had that I picked up. And I might have actually said these before in a previous episode. I can't remember, but I liked them so much I put them in there again. Drink better grains, damn it. The Misdirected Dark Ale. That's so good. Project Panda IPA.
I'm a little partial to actually both IPA and Project Panda, so yes. Yeah,
we don't pick. Well, we'll each pick one.
I'm just saying.
And then we'll send them to Kevin Lovecraft, sure. And he'll pick the winner. And then Project Reuben Slow Drip Cold Brew.
I appreciate the slow drip, the coffee reference.
Yeah, so. And this beer is espresso-infused, great for writers, but teases the senses. Note expiration date spoils easily.
Yes.
And then it went on from there because Joe Swick got in, Papa Schwick. He said, guys, I can't wait to see which beer name wins. Why? Because I plan on homebrewing the winning beer, and I'll see if I can get some of it to you.
Oh, nice. Man, that would be awesome.
And then P.K. Sullivan said, maybe we should have a brew-off. I could have a beer ready for Gen Con that can be sent for y'all to compare to Schwick's.
Oh, now we're into something.
Yep,
here.
And then Matt Bonoff said, I want it on the MMP brew-off. I won't be a Gen Con, but I might be able to send a couple of bottles there.
We're going to need to pick quickly.
Like, yeah, well, what we're going to do is, on the 30th, everybody picks one.
Yes.
That they like. Each one of us pick one that we like, you, me, and Bob. And then we send those three to Lovecraft, and then Lovecraft picks one, and then we announce it on the next show.
Excellent. Excellent.
And that show will be on a date that I am looking up right now.
I'm really disappointed now that I'm not a beer fan.
And that date will be the 5th. So the 5th of July.
5th of July.
The day after the 4th. That will be the day.
Yes, often when the 5th of July occurs.
Yes. Yeah. In fact, because it's the day after Independence Day.
Yes.
I guess. All right.
Okay.
Patreon shoutouts.
Who do we got?
The Grand Vizier of the chat room, Emily.
Ah, awesome.
Yeah. Yay. Thank you. Thank you so much, Emily, for being a patron of Misdirected Mark Productions. We also have Austin, the only person I know that probably should have a podcast that doesn't.
I've, or a blog. I may have taken steps to put him in touch with people who have a blog.
Oh, really?
That do guest posts.
Ah, Robert. Wise. Wise.
What? I may have made some introductions.
Mm. Our very own local Buffalo Fate Corps master,
yeah.
Commander, Chief Glenn Siller,
and our companion for
Swords Without Master,
Swords Without Master,
Madeline.
You know, we have an open spot on that. You just have to get your ass up early in the morning.
Yeah.
Not on night shift.
Well, not on night shift.
By the way, Austin and Glenn, thank you so much for being a patron of the Misdirected Mark Productions.
Oh, how about this next guy? I know this next guy on the list.
Secret weapon of the show, cartographer, geologist, Drew Smith.
Just awesome dude.
Yes. He posted the best pictures of him and his daughter.
Yeah, his daughter's adorable.
Yeah, Ramona. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for being a patron. And then Eric Jepson. I only know Eric Jepson from the Patreon page.
I know.
Hi, Eric. We would like to know more about you.
Yeah, Eric, by all means.
Thank you so much.
You know how to find us.
Yeah, thank you so much for being a patron of the show.
Yeah.
Feel free to talk to us. We like talking to people.
Absolutely.
All right. Now for this thing. This is a moment of Gaming MBS where we talk for a few minutes about what we liked on the last episode of Gaming MBS. Did you happen to listen to today's episode?
It dropped kind of late.
Did it?
At least it came down my podcatcher.
No, late. I got it at 1.
I was recovering from a meeting from hell by 1 o'clock.
Well, they talked about board and card games.
Nice.
Yeah, they did. They did a very nice job. They also, Matt Martinez has been like writing them every week, and they've been like taking his questions every week and responding to them. It's been pretty good because I keep thinking Kevin Keneally, because he also posts a lot. But Matt, he's been having a problem with a couple of players at his table, and he's been taking steps to solve those problems with help from the boys over there, and there seems to be working. So good for Matt and good for the boys over at Gaming MBS. But they talked about board and card games, and I was like, they don't play a lot of board and card games, man.
They don't?
Not really.
No, not like we do.
I thought I didn't play a lot of board and card games, right? Like,
yeah, but you have Jen. Like, I mean, Jen plays a ton of board and card
games. Well, I'm comparing myself to people like Mo.
Well.
Tucson.
Okay, well, that's...
Like, yeah, well, those people play board games.
He's the Canadian god of gaming.
Correct.
I don't think you really... It's unfair to compare yourself like that.
Yeah, I mean, but still, like, we play a lot of games, just not as many as that.
No. I want to play more games.
You have a bunch of games that we haven't even played. We haven't even broken out Pandemic
Legacy.
You need
to get your butt out on a Thursday one of these days to go to RonCon.
Yeah, there's that too. That was the show. It was great.
Good.
They had a bunch of...
I kind of miss those guys. Again, 2 weeks of work things eliminates driving in the morning. It eliminates my daily walk.
So here's what we're going to do, by the way.
Yeah.
So that you get a chance to listen to them. We are not going to talk about the episode that drops until a week after it drops.
Okay.
So next week, we won't actually talk about Gaming MBS, or we'll talk about this episode again.
Okay. So my homework is to go and listen to that episode.
Yes.
Okay, I do that.
So we are going to now let it sit for a week before we talk about it again.
That's fine. That's good.
Is there anybody else you want to talk about? Because a bunch of the other podcasts that I talk about usually haven't showed up because... Jim McClure left his laptop at Origins and had to have it shipped to him, so he didn't get to release his episode.
That's a talk about nail biting.
She's a Super Geek didn't have an episode this week.
No. I will mention that I finally listened to Plus One Forward.
Oh, nice.
I listened to the Threadbare episode. It was excellent. And I just tipped my hat to the Gauntlet crew because Rich did a really nice job. And I already know after listening to that episode that I'm going to just be listening to Plus One Forward from now on.
You should. That show is pretty great.
Yeah.
Did you listen to the first two episodes?
I haven't yet. I'm going to go back and I'll go back into the catalog.
It's McGay Baker and Mark Diaz Truman.
Yeah, it's fantastic. I just haven't. I mean, yeah,
it's a great show.
I've had a lot of problems catching up on podcasts. My list is full again. I'm kind of sad. Like,
podcast bankruptcy is coming.
I really don't want to because I here's what I did. I eliminated a bunch of ones that I was like, okay, I don't have to follow these when I'm behind. But things like She's a Super Geek, Gauntlet, Discern Realities, Us, like those, like I can't cut those.
Yeah, absolutely.
Startup.
Oh, I love.
I love Startup.
I love Startup.
Talking Games released on Monday.
It did. I want to talk about a show.
Okay.
So, Advantage to Insight is a very new podcast from the Visionary Comms.
Visionary.ca. Yes. I saw some postings about this.
Yes. Wayne and Alex from Visionary, they started a show. It's about D&D. I put the first episode in the Download D&D feed.
Nice.
I believe that future shows... Me and Wayne haven't really talked about it yet, but we will in the future, like, how long it'll... We'll just leave it in the Download D&D feed until they just, you know, get I just wanted to give him a jump start, give him a little bit,
I think that's an infusion.
Great. Yeah.
That's great. I mean, that's an audience that would probably be very interested in hearing.
Correct. Yeah.
Yeah.
So
that's good.
That show exists. I like their first episode was pretty good. I enjoyed it. That's why it's in the feed. I guess that's really all the podcasting that I want to talk about.
Yeah. I mean, again, I'm 2 weeks.
I could talk about a ton of podcasts, but what's the point?
You know what?
I mean, I forget all the podcasts that I listen to because I have so many of them.
Do you
want to
talk about Hamilton for a minute?
No, I'm good.
I feel like you want to talk about it.
I don't. I mean, the Black Tapes is going on right now, so there's that.
Yeah.
I mean, I love the Black Tapes, but that doesn't need my help.
No.
I mean, it's the Black Tapes. Yeah, man, Discern Realities is rocking pretty good.
Hey, can I have you just talk for a moment about where we're currently streaming the show?
We're on Hitbox.
Right. I wanted to mention this because we obviously the Chat Room for Life made it over
because
we left them the link. But we often had problems with the old chat room being able to sustain large groups. And this new Hitbox is actually much more robust.
Supposedly
more robust. We'd like to give it a test drive. And so I wanted you to mention it because I wanted to encourage listeners who currently listen to us on their podcatcher to consider coming out and checking out, I think, what is probably a better streaming environment and the ability to comment and hang out with the awesome chat room for life.
And this is the first time we've done this, and there's been a few little technical hiccups. Some people are having some lag issues, so I'm going to try to reduce the stream's
resolution.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think you actually need to see us in that high def.
Correct. So that'll be a thing that'll happen in the future. That way some people will have a better opportunity to watch what's going on and then chat with people because the chat room seems to be working quite well. People seem to like it.
Yeah.
Seem to like it a lot better than the old one.
Overall, the impression is very positive and much better than the old way.
Yeah, good. Good. I'm glad people like that. Is there anything else going on in the chat room for life that people want to talk about?
We were just having a discussion about some of the issues that some of the people have been having, and I was doing a quick browser check just to get a feel for maybe it's browser issues, because a couple people, after being on here for a while, they had to do a refresh, some things like that. Other than that, it's been I'm as close to the mic as I can get right now, Sean.
Oh, that's funny. Sean Gilgore might have said that he's not close enough to the mic.
Yeah.
I have you turned all the way up too, man.
Yeah, and I'm like close, but
yeah, you sound a little bit better now.
Yeah. In any event, that's where we are. So, but overall, positive feedback from pretty much everybody. PK Sullivan had to drop out.
Yeah.
He was having
next,
all kinds of
next week I will
problems.
Reduce the resolution. My goal for next week will be to reduce the resolution to the lowest resolution possible so we can still be seen and not as like grainy people on a screen.
And I'm going to suggest just, you know, for giggles, that when everybody comes in and gets ready to join the chat room is maybe clear your browser cache before you sign in just to start with a fresh cache.
Yeah, that would probably help.
Just to see. Oh, Paulcom, this mic picks up everything. It's not that it's not pointed at me. It's distance and enunciation.
No, he's actually right. You keep he's watching you. You keep talking to the back of the microphone. It actually does pick up out front.
You want to point it a little more at you.
Because I used to get up in here like
that's
this.
That's way better.
Ah, well, there you go. For whatever reason, since I haven't been on this mic for 2 weeks,
and now you're too loud.
Yeah, take him down a notch.
Yay.
Hey, look, we fixed Bob.
Na,
good job.
Na, 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 na.
You know, we could do this part in the after show.
We can. Yeah. So what's going on in the... is that it? Anything else?
Yeah, that's where we are.
All right.
By the way, did you notice me trying to wrap up a segment?
Yeah, good job.
Thanks.
So everything's different. Everything's new.
You know what? Seriously, two weeks of business trips and stuff, and it's like Han Solo coming out of carbonite. Like I can't. I got hibernation blindness and shit. I can't see it.
So everybody, thanks so much for listening.
If you're free Tuesday evenings, 8:45 Eastern, come join us live where you can chat with the other listeners in our awesome chat room for life.
On Hitbox.
And ask us questions or just talk to each other and just let us just babble on.
That's true. We like that also.
Yeah, we're good with that.
If you cannot make it to the live show, check out our podcast each week wherever you get your podcasts and take a listen to some of the other shows in the Misdirected Mark Network, such as Down with D&D, Threats from Gallifrey, Threats Detected, and Talking Game starring Senda and Phil. You can and should also check out some of our brother and sister podcasts. She's a Super Geek, Talking Tabletop, The Shrieker, Gaming and BS, and Advantage on Insight.
Excellent. After you have listened to us, feel free to leave some feedback. You can reach us in the old-fashioned email way by emailing chris@misdirectedmark.com.
That's me.
phil@misdirectedmark.com.
That's him.
You can go to our Facebook group.
You certainly can.
You can hit us up on Twitter, @misdirectedmark.
Where you can watch me and Chris Foster square off all the time.
That cartoon thing, just to pause for a second.
Bears.
The totally
podcast
bad,
bears.
Did totally you? Badass. All right. @misdirectedmark,
yep.
@DNAPhil, @RobertMEverson, and coming back around, @TheLight101.
Smooth jazz.
Oh, yeah.
And if you can't do any of those, or if you're on G+, go check out our G+ community.
230? 230, I think we're at.
Where Bob is keeping track of Chris now, so...
Yes.
So there's no
just
more.
In case.
I've been
how
well
many days,
behaved.
Is there a
lately?
Sign up this many days since Chris has caused an internet incident?
17.
17 days since Chris has caused an internet incident.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Okay. So Podcast Bears by Chris Foster. If you want to check that out, it's actually on the website. You can just go into the website and look. I made a comic out of his fan art and it's wonderful.
So good.
Oh, that's good. So if you'd like to be generous, you can back our Patreon and partake in the show notes that you heard earlier and get the pre-production show notes, which go out to the patrons.
Yep. Rock and Roll Play Baby, which we did not play tonight, but we're just going to credit it anyway.
Yep, sure, why not?
Is by Kieran Strange from the album Adamantium Heart, which you can find by clicking on the link in the show notes.
Yes, you can. And with that, this has been a Misdirected Mark production, the media arm of Encoded Designs. Mic drop!
Oh, I've missed you so much, Mike. Are you ready? We out!
Do-do-do. Do 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 do.
Welcome
to the after show. After show.
Yeah.
Hey everybody. What's up?
It is the after show. So
ask us anything.
Ask us anything.
Anything at all.
Anything, anything.
How much to get Phil to dress like a panda? Well, I feel like there's a number somewhere.
Oh, there's a number there, yeah.
There's a number.
So if somebody donates $100 to the Patreon.
I'll dress like... Well, how long do I have to dress like a panda?
Just 1 week.
Oh, on the show?
Yeah.
Oh, I'll totally do that. That's fine. Oh, I'll totally dress like a panda on the show. That's fine, yeah. Somebody kick in some money and I'll find a panda suit. That's
yeah.
fine.
Angela, I saw that you said that, but I was in the middle of talking, unfortunately. We'll figure out a way to do it. We'll just link to your face. I'll just link to your Gnome Stew article that's coming out at some point, I would imagine.
And Senda, yes, I will also wear panda ears at Gen Con.
After show or afterglow? Either way, Avi. Either way.
It's often the afterglow.
Avi said after show or afterglow.
I know. It's like the afterglow of yeah. podcasting.
I was at Origins for RPG Day. That's what I did.
I played
board games all day.
I went
day.
Out to Dragon Snack and got the Feng Shui rules.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Oh, man. People...
Yeah, there will be a table selfie with the panda suit. I don't know where we're going to get this panda suit from.
I'm not sure. I mean, because it's... We're going to have to find a big panda suit.
Yeah. You know what? I'll just link it. You know what? No, I got a better idea. Yeah. For the panda suit, we'll link it to the... As soon as we get enough patrons for... the $1,000 level, the new Fate Show level.
Oh, I mean, we can go lower than that. I will wear a panda suit.
No, but I want money.
Well, it's fine. You put it wherever you want it. I'll wear the suit.
Oh, that's funny.
You know, it'd be funny would be as if Senda and I actually like dressed up in panda suits and tried to record the episode.
That would be kind of funny.
Yeah.
Especially if we did it live at Gen Con.
Yeah.
And I live streamed it.
That would actually be kind of funny.
Yeah, it would be kind of funny.
Yeah, I mean, I'm up for
but
that.
But I
kind
need
of
to rent panda suits then. So I need money to rent panda suits.
Yeah, we're going to have to source those.
There's an expense that I have to look up, and then I'll figure out exactly how much money we need for that to happen.
Yeah. I don't know. If Senda was up for wearing panda suits and recording, I would totally do that.
Little panda, big panda.
Yeah, big panda.
Get Senda some bamboo. Not that she needs it.
Bamboo makes you giggle.
Apparently.
Yeah.
Oh, that's so funny.
Senda's in.
Oh,
all right,
look,
panda suits.
It looks like it's Angela already found me a website that's near here that I can get it.
Panda suit. Oh, no.
Oh, let me pull this up. Good job, Angela. Or as Brett would say, or not Brett, Sean would say, Angela. Angela.
That's right.
Yeah, I'm going to reduce the resolution of the chat room next week by half if I can. So they got Arlene's costumes. Where's the panda costume? I need a panda costume. Why doesn't this have a search?
Ask the Takedo guys. It's not Takedo guys to sponsor the episode. It's Takenoko.
Yeah, Takenoko.
Yeah. But I know where Gil Gore was going with that. Gil Gore was saying, ask the Takedo guys to sponsor the episode. Takenoko.
Oh, no. There's totally a panda mascot costume. Fantastic.
There you go.
It's $100.
So we at least have to make more than that.
Well, yes. And remember, like, so...
we have to offset the panda suit cost, and then I have to wear it.
And remember, I only get a share for the show. Everybody else gets paid, too.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I need to actually make enough money that the show, that the network can cover it.
Let me just say this. I love our listeners.
Uh-huh.
So if they pony up and rally to whatever number you ask, mm-hmm. I will happily wear the panda
suit. Probably have to be for like 2 or 3 months.
It's okay. Whatever.
Then we'll put you in a panda suit.
Yeah, whatever that takes. I'll do it, man. I'll do it.
What, the link needs to be in the community for what? For the panda mascot?
GoFundMe panda suit.
Oh, we could do that. That's what we'll do. We'll GoFundMe panda suit.
I feel like we're... you know what? You work on that part.
I'll take care. I'm open to...
I have one concern, which is how we're going to mic me when I have the big panda head on.
Oh, I'm just going to get you a lavalier and put it inside.
You know, I could actually probably steal one from work.
Well, there you go. It'll work just fine.
I'll borrow one from the AV set.
We get two of them. It's $200. We put you inside in them. It's fine.
Oh, well, now Senda has to find a panda suit. You're talking about...
No, because we're going to do it live at Gen Con.
Well, then, yeah, we should... yes, I'll do it, man. Yeah. Publicity stunt, I'm in.
I'm copying and pasting the link in the G+ community at the moment, just so we all know. Like, that's where I'm going with this. Oh, communities. How I love these so.
I do have to say, it would be pretty funny for Sunday night to record in panda suits.
I agree. I think it would be hilarious.
I think it'll be funny to see if she can keep the big panda head on while laughing.
Send a found one.
All right, let's.
Oh, it's a onesie, hoodie, pajama, animal costume, panda.
There you go.
That would be better for her since she's small, but you can wear the actual costume.
I'm taking a look.
Nice.
So here's the link. Oh, this is great. This is good stuff for the after show. I love it.
Awesome. So ask us more stuff.
Yeah.
Oh, I have an amusing thing to tell you guys.
Good.
Sunday, 2 o'clock in the morning ish.
Uh huh.
Got hungry. It was breakfast time.
Yeah.
Thought to myself, nuts to going out into the freezer and grabbing a breakfast sandwich and nuking it like that. I'm like, okay, here's what we're gonna do. I'm gonna call Denny's, and I'm gonna get takeout.
You got takeout from Denny's.
So I got takeout from Denny's. Got moons over my hammy at 2:30 and 3 o'clock in the morning.
I saw that conversation.
Pass by.
AARP discount, baby.
No. Come on.
Oh, absolutely, man. Baby.
Oh, God. Oh, it's so funny. Bobblehead send a panda. Oh, my God. We need to make those.
What's that?
Bobblehead send a pandas.
Yeah. You also have to get the Kermit one.
Yep,
for
the
me.
Kermit one for you. Yeah. Pelicom's like, no, seriously, I will send money for the panda suit. Wayne, I put it in the I put it in the.
Oh, this is gonna be a thing.
I gotta get the one. We get the one for Senda too. Oh man, we have to get. We'll have to have it.
Ooh,
here
actual
and
like
mail
question
it to
questions.
Her.
Oh, hang on.
Avi asked Chris, "What's your favorite Euro game?"
Oh,
my favorite Euro game is Puerto Rico, right now.
Very nice.
Still, I will still just play that game whenever anybody asks me to play that game.
Ooh. What's the worst fantasy game system? All right. So first of all, I don't like to bag on games, but if I would say the fantasy system I've enjoyed the least, that's a tough one.
Strictly fantasy.
It's tough. I'm trying to think of. I can't say I didn't like Palladium. Palladium is probably the bulkiest.
Yeah.
Chartmaster was never my cup of tea, but
I
don't
heard of that one.
It's not Chartmaster, it's Rollmaster.
Oh, okay, Rollmaster.
Chartmaster was never my cup of tea, but it's not a terrible game. It's just super crunchy. I think technically Fatal is fantasy, so that probably actually does count as the worst. That's the worst fantasy system. That's probably true.
Oh, sure. I actually don't have a worst fantasy system, I guess.
That's why I feel like,
you know,
Fatal,
man, I don't like RuneQuest.
I'm not a big fan of RuneQuest. BRP, I mean, I know people love RuneQuest.
BRP fantasy is not my thing. BRP Call of Cthulhu is totally my thing. BRP fantasy is not my thing.
Yeah, I get that.
I'm not a fan of that. I've never played... Okay, Ovi asked if I played Tigris and Euphrates. I've never actually played Tigris and Euphrates.
No, I know the game.
Jen has. Jen thought it was okay. So I usually just go off that because Jen is the board gamer out of the two of us.
Yes.
More so. I mean, I love board games. Don't get me wrong.
Nope, I love board games too.
Me and Jen were actually having a hard time like justifying buying certain games. Like I was going to pick up Castles of Burgundy because it was cheap.
Yeah.
And I didn't. And we're going to pick up Five Tribes because that game is fun to play and it's fun to look at.
Yeah.
And it's a bit of a medium-ish Euro. But I would really like to own Caverna because I don't want to buy Agricola or Agricola. I love the RuneQuest setting, Avi, because obviously I love the RuneQuest setting. But I don't like the game, the old game. Avi said that.
Yeah.
Numenera is totally the bastard child of fantasy and sci-fi.
Well, it's that... what's the name of that book? It's that book.
Oh, yeah, I mean...
The...
I would consider Numenera... would I consider it fantasy or sci-fi? It's science fantasy. I mean, I don't want to be flippant. Yeah. I don't want to be flippant, but it's science fantasy because that whole premise that once you get to a billion years out, nothing looks like our world, but it's based in science, not in magic.
Yeah.
It's the Arthur C. Clarke line.
Yeah, that's what it... Yeah, it's any magic that is advanced...
Any technology that's sufficiently advanced appears to be magic.
And it's actually the other way, too. Any magic that is sufficiently explained just looks like technology.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I would actually consider Numenera science fantasy.
I want to buy Caverna.
Yes.
Because I enjoyed that game, but I can't justify buying it because the only two people that I know would play it were me and Jen. Then I was like, oh, yeah, Bob would totally play that game with us.
I probably would play Caverna.
You won't like it.
I won't like it?
There are certain games that we play together sometimes that you're not into because of...
That's true. So I'll take your word for it. What mechanic is it I won't like about it?
Well, you don't like when you see a game and you feel like you're losing and then you get discouraged.
That does happen to me.
And Caverna, like, I knew six turns in, I wasn't winning.
Yeah, what was that game that we played, the Space Station one or whatever?
I forget. But,
it
like...
All right.
Like, Caverna's a game like that, though. Like, six turns in, I knew I wasn't going to win.
Yeah, and then you still got to play the rest of the game.
Yeah, and it was still fun because of... I was trying to learn the game, right?
Yeah.
Like, I needed to see how the game finished out so that the next time I could play it again. And there's, like, a billion ways to play the game, too, so that's cool.
Oh, Gilgore's asking, 78 days till the Queen City, when will the encoded events be posted? I don't know.
I suppose we could do Gen Con first.
Well, no, we have our Gen Con events posted.
No, I suppose we could get through Gen Con first.
Yeah, I mean, at some point next month I'll post our...
I mean, at some point in the next couple of weeks, 3 or 4 weeks, I'll probably have to finish editing the Buffalo Blue Cheese on the Border of Hot Sauce and stuff.
I will say this. For Queen City Conquest, we will be running Part-Time Gods of Fate.
The Airy Peaks,
and Hydro Hackers.
And whatever else I come up with.
Well, after that, it's whatever, but... Well, and you guys should run. You guys should run your D&D adventure. Whatever.
Why do I need to run organized play? At
not organized play. Run your D&D adventure.
It's not supposed to be a one shot.
Okay.
It's not. That's not how you play that. It's a series of adventures. Like, it's 12 hours of content.
Gotcha. Oh, new question: hardcover versus PDF.
Hardcover.
I will say both, and here's why. I love to collect hardcovers as a collector because much like they are the souvenir for playing a game, but I read the majority of my game books on my tablet. So I always get the PDF. Like, I will always have the PDF and read it, and then I will get the print and put it up on my shelf. You're more practical than I am.
I would rather read the hardcover. It's easier for me to learn the game from that. Plus, I can mark it up.
And really, Time Monger, if you want to start some shit in the chat room, the question you want to ask is PDF versus EPUB. In 5, 4.
Well, it's a 6-second delay.
2, 1.
It's gonna be there. Is she still in the chat room?
I think she is.
Yeah, maybe. EPUB. There it is.
But I'm
oh, I knew that was coming. Oh.
It was. It's kind of shameless.
I like books because I like to destroy them by writing in them.
Oh,
heresy!
Oh, God, Christ.
Blasphemer!
Why do you gotta say shit like that?
Because it's the way that I like to do things. I like to do that. That's why I don't have the hardcover Dungeon World book. Victor was like, "Arrgh!"
That's why I have the hardcover Dungeon World book.
Yeah, that's why I don't have the hardcover Dungeon World book. Oh. No writing books. Victor is very adamant about that.
I'm with Victor. Don't write in books.
No. I'm sorry, son. I realize I'm probably taxing your old ass laptop with the high ass resolution. I'll make sure it's better next time, my queen.
The super high res version of Phil and Chris and Bob. You can almost see that Bob's working night shift by him not shaving.
Yeah, right.
We should talk about Bob not shaving.
That's one of my flaws. I go too long between
you
shaves.
You do go. Here's the thing. And maybe we'll just repeat this next week. You clean up very nicely. So when you shave and trim your beard, it's very nice.
So what you're saying is Hobo Bob is not attractive?
But he goes all Hobo Bob, especially when he works nights because he isn't seeing people.
No.
So he's just like on the night shift. And then like each week of the night shift, he shows back up at our like here. And you're just like, well, he's just kind of letting himself go a little bit more. Like at some point, I make fun of you because it's an intervention. Yep.
Angela, if you just let me know when that Monster of the Week game is, I will just come play it because I just want to play that game.
Oh, I want to play in Angela's Monster of the Week
game. Yeah, so we'll just come play in your Monster of the Week game.
There you go.
Yeah, you know what? We'll get our shit scheduled, or you get whoever gets their scheduled first.
Well,
we'll
just the let rest
the
of us will
know.
Just sign up for it.
Because I would very much like to. First of all, I love Monster of the Week, and second of all, Angela's run so much of it. I really want to play it.
Yeah, and. I mean, it's not like there won't be a plethora of, like, indie-ish type gamers there because...
Like, Glenn will be there.
Like, Tom and his brother, Michael, will be there. And they like playing stuff like that. Emily will be there. Sendel will probably be there.
I hope so.
Yeah. Sendel will be there.
I suspect there'll be a spike in their Patreon.
I think they're... I would just give them directly money so they can just come. I mean, I'll just set aside funds.
If you do it, I'll do it.
Yeah.
I have money.
Well, I have money in some places.
That's what I'm saying. I got some money squirreled away.
Yeah.
Now you want to do that? We'll do that.
Yeah, everybody schedule their stuff for Saturday. I can only come one day, says Palcom. And Victor's coming too. Victor's going to be there too.
Yeah. Nice. Well, we called some people out.
Like, yeah, there's going to be a ton of people that are just going to play games like that are going to be there. We're going to have like our mini games on demand. Misdirected Mark games on demand.
We're just going to, I mean,
Misdirected Mark Gnome Street games
just
on
have
demand.
A fun time playing.
And sure, I'm sure John will be here.
Arcadian?
Yeah.
Oh, we'll guilt his ass up here.
Yeah, we have to.
If Angela's coming out, and if Angela's coming out, it's not going to be hard to convince. It won't be hard to convince John to get his ass up here.
Yeah. Yeah. Then we can just guilt a few more gnomes.
Yeah, he was a nice house guest. He was quite nice.
Dude, he was an excellent host.
Yeah?
Yeah.
He was quite nice hanging out at my place.
Well, there you go. John's already coming.
Yeah, John agreed to share a room with Angela. So
oh, see?
There
done.
You go.
You know, I was considering getting a room for one night downtown.
I think I might too, if I have the money for it.
I might do it because... Because I drive home every night, the thing I can't do is go drinking.
Yeah.
So if I got a hotel room downtown, I could go drinking.
You could, in fact, go drinking.
And I kind of think that might be fun.
That seems like
it might
would
be an
fun.
Idea. And, you know, if you need to offset the cost, I could split the room with you.
I will consider that.
I told Brett if he comes, he can stay with me.
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
He thought about it then, because I have a pullout couch.
I have the air mattress, so.
Yeah. So Brett is even still thinking about driving out, riding out here or whatever.
Oh, it would be so badass if Brett came out.
Oh,
I mean,
man.
Did you see Brett and Sean riding this weekend?
No.
They posted pictures. They rode. I don't know exactly where they were riding to, but they were riding.
I saw that.
Rebooting computer, no audio in case you're
blocking
my Star
Wars. I promise next time. I will reduce the resolution. Apparently, I'm killing everybody's shit with my resolution.
Well, I mean, we're learning, right? So
yeah.
We can go standard, right? Like 480.
Something smaller.
640 by 480? No.
No, I meant like 480p or something.
I have to, the height of the thing has to be 760 or so, it said.
Okay. Well, there's got to be a thing. I bet you if you look on it, like there's like settings for how to kind of reduce the
inbox. I will figure it out.
We'll do it. I'm glad actually everyone showed up. I was kind of nervous because I came downstairs. I'm like, hey, are we on the chat room page? You guys are like, no, we launched new technology.
Yeah, take it easy, Firestorm Inc. Have a good one.
Yeah, thanks, Firestorm. Oh, the ITIL exam. Is it ITIL basic or is it one of the modules? I actually know the answer to this. I'm not the specific one, but I've actually taken the ITIL basic and I've taken service design.
Cool.
Let's see if Firestorm clicked off before that. Studying for the ITIL exam is not fun.
Ty's got Cat 6. Ooh, fancy.
Fundamentals, thankfully, is what he said.
Oh, fundamentals. Oh, good luck. It's still, you got to work for that test a little. Service design was a bitch.
Night, Kilgore. Take it easy, man. Have a good
night,
one.
Night,
John. All right. Well, it's 11 o'clock.
Which is the witching hour.
Yeah, we will talk to you all later.
Pack this thing up and get out of here.
Thanks for being here. We'll talk to you all.
Oh, poor Senda. She's going to come back after rebooting. We're going to be gone.
Yeah, I know. Then she can yell at us all. It'll be great. All right. Bye, everybody.
Good night, everyone.